But enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
Yeah. We got our Kevlar on today.
No, I can't.
We got our Kevlar on.
I know what people are expecting. I just can't. I can't sit here and just keep yelling again and again. Obviously, it doesn't do any good. I mean, that's been proven. And it just, it hurts my voice.
So we stop talking about politics, hopefully?
Thank God, yes. Yeah, well, Obama, once again, elected president, 4 more years. The House and the Senate pretty much stay the same. Total gridlock.
No, this time they're going to work together.
Oh, they're
going
to work together?
No,
oh, nice.
They said that last night.
Yeah,
they're all going to just work together.
Total gridlock. Fucking nothing will get done, really, aside from the shit that Obama slips through.
Executive order shit?
Executive order stuff. His little shenanigans he's been pulling. I don't know. It's kind of a double-edged sword. It's kind of a half-full, half-empty kind of a thing because with Obama in office for another 4 years, it really is going to show what he can do and can't do. His weaknesses will be exposed. There's just, if I hear one Democrat blame George W. Bush for anything now, anything, I'm just going to yell racial epithets into their face like I was all night and all morning.
Were you losing your mind?
Dude, I was an N-bomb dropping motherfucker all day.
When did you realize that this thing was over?
When they called Ohio, really.
Yeah.
I mean, I kind of knew. I lost any hope when Pennsylvania went. Because,
mm-hmm.
I mean, Romney was campaigning hard in Pennsylvania. They're supposedly, you know, all the coal workers and you know, your blue-collar guys and stuff. Heavily union, though, so, I mean, and again, Philly just fucks Pennsylvania because the moron, mindless fucking, I gotta watch what I say. I gotta watch what I say. But that's what I'm saying. And everybody knows. The good thing about me is I've said it. I've said things so many times that I don't even have to say it. Everyone knows what I mean. And if you have an inkling that you might think you know what I'm saying, yes, that's what I'm saying. There's a certain element of people that have been ravaged economically in the past 4 years, worse than anybody else. And they're the ones celebrating the most. They're so stupid. They're so fucking stupid that they'd rather look at this man but with an emotional attachment instead of any fucking reasonable thought with the shitty situation they're in economically, and think that perhaps the president should have a business mentality. Perhaps the president should be somebody that we bring in now when we're economically fucked, that has run businesses and knows perhaps how to put in a certain things into this country that will build the economy up and build jobs up. But no, they look at this man. They see that he looks similar to them. And that's their excitement. So they jump around and dance in the streets. Well, all the while, their unemployment is twice that of fucking the national level. The poverty level is out of fucking control. And yet they're happy that this fucking guy is in for 4 more years. Well, you got him, motherfuckers. Enjoy. 4 more years. 4 more years. Enjoy it. Because you're going to be even more fucking destitute. Because let me tell you, the people that you've been sapping off of for this 4 years are done.
How did he lose Massachusetts?
That's a fucking Democratic state.
No, but he won being a governor there. It's like
it's different with the presidential
Democratic state.
He lost Michigan too.
Democratic fucking state.
Why was he supposed to win Michigan?
He had roots in Michigan.
Well, Detroit, motherfucker.
Detroit.
It's a sprinkling. Let me tell you what happens to these states. You can have a state where there's a fuckload of fucking red in there and just a couple of little patches of blue. But then the whole state goes for the fucking blue side because it's the urban areas, the high populated areas in these important states So you could have a state in the middle of America where the entire state goes red.
Right.
But they got three electoral votes.
Right.
But then you get a highly populated state because of the urban areas, and now you get this small minority of people, which is growing leaps and bounds every year, mind you, and they get to choose the election because they have the urban areas and the high populated areas in these states that have a lot of seats because of these populated areas. It's amazing. We've turned – I remember hearing over the years that the white majority – we're losing the white majority, and Hispanics and blacks are coming up, and the whites will be the minority over time. And you always thought, like, well, what's that going to do? What's that going to be like when the shift does happen?
Right.
Well, we're looking at it right now. We're getting people that are voting for people in office based purely on the color of their skin, on emotion. I mean, Jesse Jackson Jr. won his election from a mental institution. From a fucking mental institution. And he won because his stupid constituency looks at his skin.
You know, if people want to think you're crazy, you just fucking blow it around.
Holy mother of fuck.
You just brought it around.
Jesus Christ.
And he has no water. There's no water.
No clean water.
Water.
By the way, I'm going on like day 9 without power also, so it's just, I look around, I say, like, what's happening?
Mm.
Where the fuck is
LIPA?
LIPA.
It's LIPA in your area.
And the government agency. I mean, I don't need government agency help. Thank God I'm doing good enough to, but if I was, I'd be fucked, just like most of the people out on Long Island and Jersey.
What I was telling you before the show, you're not in an area that was devastated. So
tree-wise, yeah.
So, but your area should be an easy fix.
You'd think.
A very easy fix.
You'd think.
You know, I understand why no one in the Rockaways has power at this point.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Where you live, mid-island.
I know.
Now you're up to 9 days without power. That's just insane.
That's insane. 9 days. I had to MacGyver my fucking heat. So I got heat. It was just getting fucking freezing.
Well, and now we got a fucking snowstorm.
I know.
This nor'easter is bringing snow.
Yeah.
Long Island's going to get fucking hit again.
Yeah, it's moved a little further east than they said, Long Island's going to get the fucking brunt of it, and it's going to bring more colder air down.
Right.
So we're going to wind up getting some snow, mostly west and north, but
just
we're going
to
get some
shitty weather.
And we're going to get some wet shit, and with the already weakened branches and trees, wet snow on them. Jesus fuck, man.
So what's going to happen to LIPA after they take care of this whole situation? We'll just go back to business
as
usual, right?
Nothing.
Shouldn't we be dragging the executives into the street?
Something. It's all about Band-Aids.
You were telling me that people in your neighborhood are now putting up signs, signs?
Yes, I drove home and saw three houses with giant fucking signs on this white pieces of wood that they have nailed to their whatever trees are still standing in their yard.
Right.
And one said, 8 days without power, heat, nothing. And in giant letters in front of their house, like they're just so frustrated, they have to tell somebody.
Right.
Like, at least I got a radio show. They just have to put a sign in their yard.
That's
people are pissed.
That's their radio show.
The gas lines?
Right.
Still. Yesterday, there was fucking Nassau County cops came swooping in to the gas station near my house when a tanker truck pulled up and started dumping fuel in.
Right.
And people just like ants, like locusts, just swarmed on the station. And Nassau had to come in and start directing traffic, stopping fights, people yelling at each other. And I was going to wait for gas, but I couldn't. It did the line.
So what the fuck are they saying? When is the power going on?
Well, when you listened to Bloomberg yesterday, he was talking and saying, I would have thought that the gas would have gotten to where it needs to be. Quite frankly, I'm just hoping, you know, it's going to, one day you will wake up and it will be better, he said.
That's good.
That's his explanation. One day you'll wake up and it'll be better.
That's good.
How about you wake up freezing? You wake up fucking...
We could have said that.
Yeah.
You're the mayor. we could have said that.
I could say it. Well, one
That's
day
something
I'll wake
we
up
would
and,
say.
And there'll be gas.
Oh,
no,
God.
The gas lines are still insane. And now I'm at the point again where I'm looking at my gas gauge, I'm looking at my gas cans, and today, at
it's
some point
day?
Today, I am going to have to venture out and find some fucking gas. And people go, boo-hoo, oh, poor Anthony. You know, fuck your mother. Because it's a pain in the ass.
It's not poor Anthony. I got family. And we all can relate.
It's 9 days of this shit so far, and I've had it.
I mean, I can't relate. I never lost power.
I hadn't either.
And, you know, the AC was cranking again last night because the building's a little warm. Yeah. But I can relate because I got, like, family members that are going through what you're going through.
Of course.
You know the West Side Highway last night? I was going southbound to the cellar. It's the worst traffic I've ever seen in New York on the West Side Highway. And it's all because of that. They said the Hess Station and that whole area.
It's the Hess Station and the fact that there's no Holland. Well, the Holland Tunnel opened up this morning. Right. Last night, there was no Holland Tunnel.
I didn't know that.
There's no a battery tunnel. Mm. So you're just backing everyone up. A lot of these people, they're either going north to the fucking bridge. The Lincoln Tunnel.
It just seems that, I don't know, we should be further along in the recovery.
Yes!
Not in the Rockaways and all these, and the Jersey Shore, obviously, but these regular neighborhoods.
Well, you know what? No one is coming in. No one's talking about FEMA. No one's talking about the president hating white people, black people, whatever, like they did with George W. Bush and blamed him for Katrina and all that happy horse shit. So it just sits there, and time goes on, and the country doesn't care. You know, the big story around the country is the election.
Well, of course.
The big story here is the fact that we got a storm coming in, and there's still people fucking homeless in rickety houses in areas where trees are still falling on people's heads. A guy just died fucking yesterday trying to clear his yard, and a tree fell on his head.
Jesus.
I mean, people are still dying from this shit. And
can't you get out?
Nothing is being done.
Can't you get out of the way of trees falling?
You'd think they'd fall slow, right?
Yeah, but I don't know. I'm just asking.
That's timber.
This election, though, me and Ann were talking for a while before the show, and it's a weird process because as we all wake up this morning, you realize that half of the country is absolutely not happy.
Yeah.
With this election.
When you hear Obama say the American people have spoken.
No, they haven't spoken.
Half of them are pissed.
This is where we're at in this country now.
The divided states.
There used
of
to
America.
Be a time where when the president was elected, there was a lot of times, way more than 50% of the people were happy.
At least
at this point, it's 50 people are happy, and 50% of the people are miserable with this selection.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's our country in a nutshell.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think that's good.
No.
I don't think that's good.
It's
And you can't be really the one strange. Saying the people have spoken. Absolutely not.
No, I mean, we're...
Half the people have spoken.
Did he mention... 50, I'm sorry.
What, 52%?
We're more divided now than ever.
Did he mention how close it was or no, Obama?
Well, we got his speeches. We got a lot to do.
Did he mention it was that close? Because they said he should have acknowledged that it was that close.
I didn't listen to it. I watched the election like I watch the World Series when your team is losing. And it's that last out, and it pops into the outfield, and the guy gets under the ball, and the people start cheering because they know they're going to win, and you know they're going to lose. And the second the ball hits the guy's glove, and you know he made the catch,
right.
I fucking change the channel because I don't want to see the adulation or hear this shit.
Well, what do you want to do? We got Romney and Obama. We got some clips.
Well, we got it.
Which one you want to do first?
Well, I guess Romney gave his concession
speech
do
the Romney
first, and then Obama gave his...
Man.
His speech, thank God.
Is he thinking, what a waste of time that was?
Man, time and fucking money.
Time and money.
Down the shitter.
What a waste.
Oh, boy.
That all or nothing shit is intense.
Yeah.
He gets nothing. He doesn't even get a participation trophy.
I think his speech was good, though. It wasn't that long, and I thought his concession speech was good, just like McCain's was 4 years ago. I thought it was very eloquent and
they're
nice.
They're all very magnanimous and very fucking...
But by Friday, no one will say his name at all.
No, he's back fucking just done.
Just being a Romney somewhere.
Ryan got reelected to his seat.
Oh, nice.
So he just goes back to
And they didn't get Wisconsin either, did they?
No.
But that was going to be a tough one, wasn't it?
That's always a tough one, but...
They were hoping with Ryan on the ticket that would help.
Yeah, yeah.
But it did not.
Well, you know what? I also am grateful that racism is, just one of those things now. It's just one of those things that people have to deal with in this country. Like, everyone has their crosses to bear. Every group of people, gays and stuff. And you just kind of get through it. Well, black people have got to now just... deal with the fact that there will be racism. There'll always be racism. But obviously, it's not as bad as they think it is. And any obstacles that are in your path aren't put there by a statewide racist government and entity when a black man can be elected president, not just once like a fluke, but twice and over two white guys that would normally have looked like your stereotypical president and vice president. So when they can be elected, when Obama can be elected like this again, I am now completely done with catering to any black causes, being called a racist, any of these excuses that racism is has come into play in their life and they can't do this, can't do that. They're being blocked from this, that, affirmative action. That all is done. And I mean this time really fucking done. Well, I'm going to start. If I want to use racial epithets, I'm just going to use them because anyone else can with any other group. Congratulations, black people. You made it. You made it. You're part of the country. Congratulations. You're now officially unfettered to do anything you want in this fucking nation. Oh, you're always going to have racists.
Can you tell me?
And racism. But it's just something that you got to deal with. A bad part of the country. Like, I got to deal with taxes, and I got to deal with bullshit people sapping off of me. You have to deal with a certain amount of hatred and racism based on your behavior, by the way. But congrats. You're in. You're in. Welcome. Welcome to the club, black people. Welcome.
Now, what happened to Jesse Jackson's son again?
He won office from a mental institution. Batshit crazy. They elected him because of nothing but his name and the fact that his constituency looks like him.
But that shouldn't be allowed.
It shouldn't.
Shouldn't you have to pass some exams before you run? If you're unstable, you should not even be allowed to be in it.
Could you find Craigslist if they are selling lawn jockeys? I'm going to put one on my lawn. Just for the hell of it.
You already have one.
I got a little one in the backyard.
Yeah.
I want one of those big ones
on each side of my driveway holding the lanterns.
Why don't you wait and you see what the LIPA guys look like who show up at your house?
Yeah, maybe the LIPA guys are.
Well, based on how long it's taken to fix my shit, you're probably right.
Here's Romney from last night.
I think black people.
Romney fucked up. Because I kind of wanted to lie. Last night I was kind of like, I hope Romney wins for tax purposes. But then I'm like, I don't know. Like, George Bush, at least whether you hate him or loved him, you knew who Bush was. Like, you knew he's a religious conservative. You know what he is. This is what Bush hates abortion. He hates this. You knew it, whether you like him or hate him. With Romney, I had no fucking idea.
You don't think it would put out enough of what
he's
all about?
No, and it's because this dummy wasted too much time trying to convince other Republicans that he'd be hard-nosed. Which was stupid. They were never going to vote for Obama over him. He fucked up.
That's true.
And that stupid video of him, even though I know it was taken out of context, but to get caught out there saying what he was saying, which seemed like a private moment, was dumb.
It was, but he only alienated the people that were already not voting for him.
Probably right.
A lot of blacks, a lot of Hispanics voted for him. A lot of these, the white guilt in this country, I'm so surprised it's still there. I think if Obama continues for the next 4 years, like he has been for the past four, there's going to be a big turnaround. Because now everyone's like, all right, look, we're giving you another shot. We're going to give you the 4 years you've been asking for. But, you know, no more blaming George W. The unemployment rate's got to come down. This economy's got to come back. We got to start producing and selling stuff again. We can't let China steamroll over us. We can't let other countries steamroll us. We got to present ourselves still as a strong nation. And he's going to be under a microscope for this stuff.
This is you should look at it in a positive way. This is your jumping off point. This is your,
I'm done.
No, this is your chance to become a political talk show host.
Fuck that. I'm so done with politics.
Did you hear the first 20 minutes of this show? Fox is not going to hire that and go, all right, cool, because you didn't actually say it. You said they look like him and they're dumb.
Right. Exactly. I went on a fucking blocking binge last night on Twitter, by the way. I'm done. So I'm done. Like, during the 18 months of fucking campaigning we've had, or even longer, whatever it's been, I've started following a lot of people with opposing viewpoints politically, especially a lot of these celebrities and whatnot. Michael Moore, Sarah
Silverman.
You think
he's happy today?
Oh, he's fucking ecstatic.
You think Sarah Silverman's very happy today?
Sarah Silverman's hairy pussy is smiling. That big hairy fucking stank bush is smiling. But every time I saw their tweets of adulation, block any kind of ha-ha Anthony. And I've seen there are people that follow me, perhaps even fans of the show, block. I must have blocked hundreds of people. Hundreds of people. I blocked until Twitter said you can't block anymore in this 24-hour period.
Wait,
I guess you're only allowed to
block. That happens?
Yes.
And you got a notice from Twitter?
I didn't even know that was possible. I hit the bell. I hit the mark.
I bet that's in case I bet that's in case somebody hacks your account. They can't block everybody.
Probably.
They can't fuck you.
That's probably
so
a fail.
Start all over again today.
I hit the mark.
Look, we got lots to do. Why don't we do some Romney here? Then we got some Obama stuff. Then we got Donald Trump's tweets. Ugh. Then we got Diane Sawyer drunk. It's all over the place today.
Yeah.
Lots to do.
Lots.
Here's Romney from last night.
I have just called President Obama to congratulate him on his
victory. I called him, too.
By the way, this is the shit that I fucking hate about politics.
Oh, yeah.
18 months, they're like basically saying, this guy's the fucking devil. He's the worst thing for the country, blah, blah, blah. They've pretty much strangled each other. And then the night of the election, it's all like, oh, I called him to congratulate him.
Yeah.
I fucking hate the phoniness of the whole thing.
It really is so
funny.
Why
do you have to be a sport in the end?
It's phony. It is. You're right.
Because it's all bullshit. You don't believe this.
And what he's saying right there and what they all say is, I'm either full of shit now or I was full of shit when I was bad.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's why I hate this whole process, because it's there's so much phoniness to it.
Do you know who's
you
great?
Fucking hate Obama and you think he's the worst thing for the country. So, but now you're going to like be the rah-rah guy? For what reason?
And he was calling Romney, blatantly calling him a liar.
Right.
And now he's, you know, hey, great campaign.
Right.
Good man, Bob.
I have just called President Obama to congratulate him on his victory. His supporters and his campaign also deserve congratulations.
Why, for bashing
him? I wish all of them well, but particularly the president, the first lady, and their daughters. This is a time of great challenges for America, and I pray that the president will be successful in guiding our nation.
See, that's a statement he doesn't believe.
No.
I wonder if the real people that run this country are backstage with a gun, like, okay, now this is what you have to do.
This is what you got to say.
Now this is what you have to say. We wrote it out for you. Why can't the guy be honest at that point? Like, the people have spoken. You elected Obama, but I still think it's a bad idea.
Yeah. I don't think he's a good guy for the job. That's what he believes. Yeah.
He continues.
The nation, as you know, is at a critical point. At a time like this, we can't risk partisan bickering and political posturing. Our leaders have to...
But we just did that for 18 months.
Yeah, didn't we?
We just did that for 18 months.
18 long
months. We just wasted 18 months. But now we shouldn't do that anymore, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I fucking hate this shit.
Because it says I've been lying to you up until yesterday.
Right.
Yeah. Or I've been playing a game up until yesterday. It's even worse when they do it in their own party.
Right.
Yes.
This you know how he's opposite politically.
Right.
When Democrats and Republicans do it to each other in primaries... How do you fucking believe a word they say that's positive about each other?
Then
ever
they turn
again?
Around and go, well, you know, I'm out of the race now, but he is absolutely the guy.
Yeah, and then the guy appoints the guy he was beating the shit out of.
The worst was Newt Gingrich.
No, he's the
he beat the shit out of all his guys there.
Yeah.
And he's on. He's been on all the news channels rah-rah-rahing fucking Romney. He didn't believe it during the primaries. He thought he was Romney was the worst choice for the party.
Yeah.
I fucking hate this shit because it's bullshit.
Do you know who said all this last night and who was amazingly fair? It was Shep Smith on Fox. I couldn't believe how good he was. Like,
he's pretty good.
Talking about exactly this, how we're supposed to believe these guys when they bash each other. And he was bashing Romney, too, and Obama.
Yeah, right.
He was
kind of Shepard's pretty good.
I should have said Shepard instead of Shep, like I'm his fucking coworker.
He's one of the guys on Fox I do watch.
I really liked him.
I watch him more than probably any of them on Fox.
Yeah.
But now it's time to bring the whole country together, even though we just fucking tore each other apart for 18 months. So stupid. You know how much stuff we could have got done in the last 18 months?
Yep.
Yeah, well.
Our leaders have to reach across the aisle to do the people's work. And we citizens also have to rise to the occasion. We look to our teachers and professors. We count on you not just to teach, but to inspire our children with a passion for learning and discovery.
Oh, please.
We look to our pastors and priests and rabbis and counselors of all kinds to testify of the enduring principles upon which our society is built. Honesty, charity, integrity, and family.
Yeah.
We look to our parents. For in the final analysis, everything depends on the success of our homes.
Okay.
We look to job creators of all kinds. We're counting on you to invest, to hire, to step forward. And we look to Democrats and Republicans in government at all levels to put the people before the politics. I believe in America. I believe in the people of America.
I don't.
By the way, a little side note. Our app isn't working again.
Why would it?
Everyone is fucking losing their minds saying the fucking app's not working.
It's Obama.
Engineering knows they've been working on it since it started. It's the third party. It's not from here.
So why do they have a third party who's not doing it?
I don't want a
wasn't I invited?
Well, I do want a third party, but I don't want a third party when it comes to our app.
Yeah.
Oh. Don't we have enough people in-house that could fucking be on that all the time?
Like, there must be somebody at that third party that really just doesn't like the show.
There absolutely
and
is.
And loves to just cut us off because they can.
We've said that so many times, and nobody listens. Like, nobody investigates that. It absolutely
because we don't have the right guys running the channel, period.
Someone that
and that's not
like
a bitch,
it.
By the way, Sam. It's just a fact. Yeah. We don't have the right guys.
Do you know?
Because this is the only channel that the app goes out all the time. All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
All the fucking
all
time.
All the
people
time.
Love listening to this show on their phones. Phones are really important right now in broadcasting.
Probably some guy named Daryl Obama. Your cousin.
And we, and we got an app that just
your
goes
cousin,
out all the
Marvin
time.
Obama.
You know where else Romney fucked up on that last foreign policy debate? He did not look like he was. And even though he said some smart stuff, but he did not look like he. Even though the economy is what everybody said, but he didn't look like he didn't look president. He looked great in the first one.
Mm-hmm.
Second one, yeah, okay, not fine. But the third
the
one, he didn't look good at all.
One, he
and it was the look on
lost.
His face. It was that half a smile, that smirk.
He looked lost. He was trying to bring it every question back around to domestic issues.
Yeah.
Because it's very hard for a former governor to really talk about foreign policy.
I mean,
the fact that he didn't have the experience of foreign policy, well, neither did Obama when he took office.
I don't think that should be the main thing in a debate.
It should be. And it isn't.
Because it's not fair to the one guy that hasn't really done that yet.
Yeah.
It's just not fair.
And the truth of the matter is the economy was what everybody put as their number one thing. So why would you vote for a guy that didn't do anything for the economy in 4 years? It just languishes there instead of a businessman that, you know, might have done something. Well, I'm not even saying he would have.
Here's your businessman. One more clip from Romney's speech last night.
And I ran for office because I'm concerned about America. This election is over, but our principles endure. I believe that the principles upon which this nation was founded are the only sure guide to a resurgent economy and to renewed greatness. Like so many of you, Paul and I have left everything on the field. We have given our all to this campaign.
Sure.
I so wish that I had been able to fulfill your hopes to lead the country in a different direction.
Yeah.
But the nation chose another leader.
No, half the
nation. And so Ann and I join with you to earnestly pray for him and for this great nation. Thank you and God bless
He's
America.
Earnest.
You guys are the best.
And earnestly go to camp.
He ends with, you guys are the best.
Yeah, hey, thanks for nothing.
You guys
nothing.
Are the best.
I'm just going to go back to the private sector
well,
and fucking...
thanks for nothing.
Make all this money back that I fucking spent doing this shit.
Yeah, he'll make that back easily.
Ah,
right?
That's nothing. No problem for him.
He should have been the moderate he was all along.
Yeah,
I'm telling you, because that fucking trying to... I hate to say kowtow... To the he had to be a good moderate. he's more of a moderate than a lot of conservatives are. He's not a fucking hardcore religious Republican.
Yep. He might have swayed some
yes,
of the moderates.
He's really not a scummy, horrible, heartless businessman. And they took what he said about Detroit. When he said bankrupt Detroit, didn't he mean then you can start over?
Go into bankruptcy protection. Not, but people don't hear that.
Yes.
They hear bankrupt. People don't know what bankrupt means. They mean let them go bankrupt, which they just picture the shutters being put on the windows of the factory.
Right.
And no, bankruptcy protection, like many companies, especially after 9/11, a lot of the airlines did it and stuff. That's what he meant. Just not a government bailout and government subsidies helping them get out of bankruptcy, but not backing them completely with the government money.
And this is a mistake he made, I thought, by not going. I know these are all talk shows like Letterman and The View, but there was a lot of opportunities to have conversations in these places. that are a little bit different than you have in political forums.
Yeah.
Like, these are things he could have explained. Sitting with these dummies on The View, they're not going to be blatantly rude to him.
Right.
He could have absolutely said, what I meant by that was this, and had plain language discussions with people, and he would have seemed more relatable. I told you, he fucked up by not doing that. He's probably a much nicer guy than he came off of.
I don't think he knows that world.
No.
I think he knows he would have been eaten alive by Letterman and some of these other shows.
Pierre Ops?
Maybe.
Just my hunch. I don't know.
It is kind of a, though, for the Romney supporters out there that are devastated, I'm sure. It is kind of a, but it is kind of a cut off your nose to spite your face thing, because I hate the fact that I think this is bad for the country, but I do like the fact that he will be exposed now. He will be exposed. And this isn't paranoia talking. He's a bad president. He's not a good, especially on domestic issues and the economy. The guy doesn't understand what this country needs to get back into the world market. I don't think he does.
One of the guys that is devastated today is Donald Trump.
Yes.
Furious Trump calls for a revolution after disgusting injustice, sham, and travesty of Obama's re-election.
Go back to your casino and your fucking...
Moments after the president's victory was projected by several news outlets last night, Trump took to Twitter to voice his outrage, demanding a revolution.
Yeah, that's what we get. Trump demanding a revolution instead of, if it went the other way, the fucking cities would be burning today.
He also said that the Democrats' re-election to office was a great and disgusting injustice.
But how is it an injustice if he actually did get the popular vote and the Electoral College by 103? Yeah.
Well,
or was it by 97?
In all fairness, when he started tweeting, Romney was still ahead as far as the popular vote goes.
Oh, really?
More votes equals a loss. Revolution. Let's fight like hell and stop this great and disgusting injustice. The world is laughing at us. We can't let this happen. We should march on Washington and stop this travesty.
It's the way the world laughs.
Our nation is totally divided. Well, he should start marching and see who fucking joins him.
He's right about the country being divided.
It's
very, very polarized right now.
It's been divided for the last at least 4 years at this point.
Worse now than ever, even in 4 years.
Getting worse, sure.
Yeah, yeah.
But he didn't have more votes. He should take these down.
Well, I know. Well, when he did tweet that, that was the case. The phony Electoral College made a laughingstock out of our nation. The loser won. He lost a popular vote by a lot and won the election. We should have a revolution in this country. Well, back to the drawing board, he tweeted. Truth will ultimately prevail where there is pains to bring it to light.
The truth is, Obama won the popular vote.
George Washington. That was George Washington.
Yeah,
vote.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
He won the popular vote.
Yeah. And I'm actually glad he won it, because I hate when somebody... I think, didn't Clinton get in with losing the popular vote?
Bush did.
Bush lost
over Gore. Gore got the popular vote.
Gore got the popular vote by a half million.
Yeah.
Half million more votes, and he was not the president.
But I mean, it's like, is Trump complaining about that? It's like, stop it. I want the guy to win the popular vote, though. Like, I'm glad he won it, because then I can't go, fuck, he lost the popular
vote.
It's
so close that it really is inconsequential as far as what it really means, is like how the American people feel. Half the American people don't want this guy president.
Sure.
That's pretty much what this said.
Mm-hmm.
When Reagan won, yes. 49 states to one. I wonder, can you just look it up, Sam? What the
49 states to
over,
one.
Over Moynihan and, not Moynihan, Ferrara. No. Geraldine Ferrara and,
Oh, God.
I forgot.
Not Moynihan.
No, the other guy. Fucking
Walter Mondale.
Mondale, right.
I want to know what the popular vote was. I'm sure Reagan won that, too.
And what state did Mondale win?
Dude, I don't know. Yes. Not his home state, though.
Hello.
I'm going to guess something like New Hampshire or Maine or Vermont. Some like wild.
He won 50. Minnesota, Wisconsin, what? 50%. Montana, no, what?
Oh, so he won. He got 60%.
60% of the popular vote Reagan got.
That's it.
Yeah, I mean, 20%
even
more.
In a landslide
that's
like
a,
that.
That's a landslide, though. 60% is huge.
Yeah, right.
You're really never going
to
get a...
We haven't seen anyone come close to that since.
No.
49 to 1.
What did he win? What state did Mondale get?
That one over there.
Look at that.
Left of Illinois.
Fucking,
left of Illinois.
Oh, I was so wrong.
What state is that, Sam? I can't see.
Read it.
The blue one.
Yeah, it doesn't have a name on it. It's 10.
Let me see it. I'll show you. I'll tell you. I know.
None
of
us know our geography.
Oh, I know that.
What state is that?
I can't.
Michigan. Oh, that's Iowa.
Iowa.
We just don't know our geography. I get lost in the middle.
No, that's
in
Wisconsin.
The middle of the fucking.
No, that's
country.
Idaho.
I said
Idaho. No, that.
Which one is it? Why don't we know our geography?
We never need to look at maps anymore. Maps are for fucking queers.
No.
I could pretty much do the whole East Coast, and then I could scrape along to Texas,
Minnesota,
and then I can. I know all the way around the fucking perimeter.
That's Minnesota.
You sure?
Yeah.
The middle is where it gets rough. I don't know those states. Here's Obama.
Tonight, more than 200 years after a former colony won the right to determine its own destiny, the task of perfecting our union moves forward.
What?
It moves forward because of you. It moves forward because you reaffirmed the spirit that has triumphed over war and depression, the spirit that has lifted this country from the depths of despair to the great heights of hope, the belief that while each of us will pursue our own individual dreams, we are an American family and we rise or fall together as one nation and as one people.
I can't pursue my dreams with you in office. I can't.
But that's not true.
You pursue your dreams, and then you're just crucified for fucking achieving them.
52% are about that.
All right, Reverend Al has to go to the hospital. Could someone fucking just drive Reverend Al to the hospital? What the fuck is wrong with him?
I don't know.
Oh, God, I hope he's sick.
He looks...
He's not. He got that lap band. It's obvious.
Lap band?
He got that lap band shit.
Oh, please be sick.
That looks like one of my Halloween decorations.
He looks
awful.
He's
terrible.
He looks like a rotting apple.
What else? When it comes to Obama, the one thing I didn't like, and the one thing I did like about Romney is I hate the fact that I'm going to pay more taxes. I resent that. I'm tired of hearing fair share. I give
fair
my
share.
Fair share. But what else about him? Like, I'm trying to think, like, I didn't mind anything else about him other than the financial angle. And that's a big one, but I can't think of other things that I didn't like.
He weakens the nation. He's not a strong leader. He weakens this nation in its image, its world image, internationally. He weakens it economically with his social programs that cost a fuckload of money and don't bring money in. He's spending like a fuck on things that don't produce. They don't pay back. He's borrowing money to put his shit in place, and his shit does not pay off. That's the problem. He's weakening this nation. He's turning this nation into one of these socialist countries that don't really produce. That's the problem with him. He doesn't have a business-oriented mind. He has a welfare-oriented mind. He's betting on the impoverished to support him. That's what he did. How do you lose when your constituents are the people that receive your free shit? He's giving away stuff. Of course they love him. Fuck.
We'll just break all that down in 4 years from now and start over.
Yeah, perhaps.
Who do Republicans have? You think Ryan? Can run?
Chris, 4 years? Chris Christie.
Maybe.
He would probably be the...
If Christie loses some fucking weight.
I'm telling you.
Fat president since, like, what, Taft?
Yeah. There's something
the
about...
The go-to fat guy, Taft.
Would have loved Taft. I think he should really play it up, and Christie should grow that big mustache.
I agree with
that. Big walrus mustache.
And we can never forget that, as we speak, people in distant nations are risking their lives right now just for a chance to argue about the issues that matter. The chance to cast their ballots like we did today. But despite all our differences, most of us share certain hopes for America's future. We want our kids to grow up in a country where they have access to the best schools and the best teachers.
Union schools and teachers.
A country
stop
that
kissing the union's asses. We get
it. A global leader in technology and discovery and innovation.
Yeah.
With all the good jobs and new businesses
jobs.
That follow.
Where?
We want our children to live in America that isn't burdened by debt. That isn't weakened by inequality.
What?
That isn't threatened by the destructive power of a warming planet.
Oh. Destructive power of the warming planet.
you fucking cunt.
No. It's really strange as you listen to this. Mm. Didn't he say this 4 years ago?
Of course he did.
It's really strange that he was saying this last night.
Now he can talk
last night
about...
should have been a different speech.
Dude, you could hear him. Now he can talk about things like global warming. Before the election, he wouldn't have mentioned global warming. He would have hinted to it. But now you're going to see the unaccountable Barack Hussein Obama. You're going to see a guy that doesn't have to worry about a re-election, and he's going to bring up shit like this. Everyone was saying, you know, you still got to keep your guns for the 4 years he was in. Yeah, he didn't want to turn off the fucking gun lobby completely by going after the Second Amendment. You're going to start seeing the unaccountable Barack Hussein Obama.
But... they said someone raised a point that at least one or maybe two more justices will be appointed in this next 4 years. And I don't want an arch conservative Supreme Court. That was something I kind of am concerned about. You know, I don't want to. I prefer a bit more of a liberal Supreme Court than an arch conservative one. Right. I do not want that.
Yeah, that's.
I agree with you, Jimmy, on that.
Yeah. You know, whatever. I don't mind. I don't mind things like abortion. Fuck it. Rip them out. Rip them the fuck out, because most of them are useless pieces of shit anyway. Fuck them.
Yeah.
And gay marriage, good. Fucking take your cock and shove it up your pal's asshole. I don't care.
Please isolate that for the beginning of the show. Get your cock and shove
all
up your
that
pal's
shit
asshole.
It means nothing in the grand scheme of this country. That shit doesn't mean anything.
Maine and Maryland became the 7th and 8th states to legalize same-sex marriage.
Well, congratulations, homosexuals. Congratulations. You can now suck each other's cocks and eat each other's box in public and flaunt your wedding rings and your beautiful ball gowns. Whatever you want to fucking do. Get together, get married, be miserable like everyone else that's married. Good. Congrats.
By itself, the recognition that we have common hopes and dreams won't end all the gridlock or solve all our problems or substitute for the painstaking work of building consensus and making the difficult compromises needed to move this country forward. But that common bond is where we must begin. Our economy is recovering. A decade of war is ending. A long campaign is now over. And whether I earned your vote or not, I have listened to you.
Oh, shut up.
I have learned from you. And you've made me a better president.
What?
And with your stories and your struggles, I returned to the White House more determined
to
and
make
more inspired
struggles
than ever about the work there is to do and the future that lies ahead.
Damn, that sounds good.
But it sounds...
That sounded good.
It sounds very much like a politician's speech. Like I would have preferred...
He doesn't rally the people to make... He's not bringing the people together. It sounds too much like he's trying. When you had a president like Reagan, he absolutely was able to unite the nation, whether you agreed with him or not. Like, he was a no-nonsense kind of guy. This just sounds like a political thing. And you know damn well this president has proven over the past 4 years he is not a uniting president. Sorry, he's just not.
This country has more wealth than any nation.
Yeah,
but that's
you'll
not
fix
what
that
makes us rich.
Of course not.
We have the most powerful military in history, but that's not
we
what
did
makes us strong.
Well, wait till 4 years goes
our
by.
Our university, our culture, are all the envy of the world, but that's not what keeps the world coming to our shores.
You'll fix that.
What makes America exceptional are the bonds that hold together the most diverse nation on earth.
Yuck.
The belief that our destiny is shared. That this country only works when we accept certain obligations to one another and the future generations, so that the freedom which so many Americans have fought for and died for comes with responsibilities as well as rights, and among those are love and charity and duty and patriotism. That's what makes America great.
You know what obligations to one another means? Do you know what obligations to one another means?
Good?
I don't want the government telling me I'm obliged to anything.
I agree.
I'm obliged to pay my taxes so the government can fix the shit I use in this country. That's it. I'm not obligated to help anyone.
I want to help my family. I'm going to help my friends.
Of course, I do. And I do that, too. And I help perfect strangers sometimes. I don't give a shit. But it's, I don't want to be obligated. An obligation? Go fuck yourself.
Yeah, that is kind of that is a bit of a that's the one word. As soon as I heard that, I'm like, that's what bugs me. I don't like being told I'm not doing enough when I know I am, and I'm okay to pay. I don't mind paying taxes.
You just don't want to be told that you're not doing enough,
dude. I don't want to be. I
agree with that point as well, Jimmy.
I don't want to be 50% partners with the fucking government
when they're just throwing the money away. Also,
yeah,
and then to have the people that you're giving your money to turn around and then tell you you're not doing enough. Oh, man, is that fucking infuriating.
If I
have a house guest, and I've said this before, have a house guest, let him fucking be in your house and use your shit, and then have him turn around and go, you're a piece of shit. Why don't you give me more? I want a bigger room. You're like, my motherfucker, I'm fucking supporting you. Mm. You throw him out is what you do if it was your house.
Yeah.
That's a microcosm.
I believe we can keep the promise of our founding. The idea that if you're willing to work hard, it doesn't matter who you are,
we'll fuck
or where
you, anyway.
You come from,
yeah.
Or what you look like,
yeah.
Or where you love.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter whether you're black or white or Hispanic or Asian or Native American or young or
we
old
get it.
Or rich or poor,
yeah.
Able, disabled, gay or straight.
Ah, oh, shit, we're not going to be able to bully anymore.
Oh, that was to get obvious. Gay or straight in, by the way.
Uh-huh, gay or straight.
You can make it here in America if you're willing to try.
America!
I believe we can seize this future together because we are not as divided as our politics suggests. We're not as cynical as the pundits believe.
Yeah.
We are greater than the sum of our individual ambitions, and we remain more than a collection of red states and blue states. We are, and forever will be, the United States of America. And together, with your help and God's grace, we will continue our journey forward.
Uh-huh.
And remind the world just why it is that we live in the greatest nation on earth. Thank you, America. God bless you.
His black scent is coming through.
OMG.
I mean, you can see how a white girl can fall for me.
Look at that map, though, man.
Did you hear his black scent coming through?
America. I would say being created. He doesn't have a black scent. He's a fucking Harvard Law Journal nerd.
Oh, is he?
Yes.
Is he a Harvard Law Journal? I don't know.
But
I don't know. I haven't seen anything from Harvard or any of the other fucking universities. How about you fucking release that shit now?
Yeah,
and let's see what you're all about, really.
That should all be released.
Of course.
All that stuff. Everything
I'm offering $10, by the way.
He definitely,
$10 for him to fucking release it.
He definitely sounds different than he has in the past 4 years.
He's talking about things that the day of the election, the second he won the election, he's now talking about these controversial things. He's kind of sliding them in there, these controversial things that he never would have addressed during the election.
All right, well, you got the Ed Schultz.
Oh, God, here we go.
So
I like Ed Schultz.
Fuck Ed Schultz in his fucking ass.
Not a fan of Ed Schultz.
You don't like Ed Schultz?
Fucking... Nah,
he's trying to be the Rush Limbaugh for the other side.
Oh, good.
Oh, good luck.
He
good for you.
He dreams of being the Rush Limbaugh for the other side. He works for MSNBC, and this is what he had to say.
Oh, God.
In the face of obstruction, this president is going to go down in history as one of the great ones because of all the obstruction and all of the social things that he had to face and all of the comments coming from the Tea Party.
Fuck
President
you.
Obama wins re-election, I think, on his record tonight, sticking up for American workers. If you look at the map, you see where unions put their resources is exactly where the president won tonight. He won the Rust Belt, and he won where he had to win. A flawless campaign.
Ed Schultz, go fuck your mother's asshole. Fuck Ed Schultz.
Well, it was flawless.
He did run a good campaign. He won.
It was an amazing campaign.
He won.
It was flawless.
It was, again, you know, both sides, but it was a filthy campaign.
Are we going to bring this nation together now?
Nope.
Of course not.
It's completely divided and polarized, and it will only get worse.
Look at the map. It's obvious that we could easily split this country.
Why don't we just do it, please?
That's so obvious.
Why don't we just have a fucking civil war and really get the two fucking...
There's a lot of red south of us. A lot of red.
Oh, God.
Disgusted.
Ed Schultz, my ass.
You need another party. Yes. I'm telling you, it's because these guys, they know they can divvy it up. Okay, I'll be the social liberal, the kind of socialist. You be the conservative. It's like you have to pick and choose. Do I hate him less than him? Yeah. There's nobody alike. Did anybody really like Romney, or you just hate him less than Obama? Uh-huh. None of them represent what fucking most people want.
No.
None of them do.
Yep. Hey, yep.
What else? Tammy Baldwin, congratulations to her. She becomes the first openly gay senator to win.
Yeah, there you go.
She did it in Wisconsin.
Oh, really?
And the
Let's
biggest...
Let's take a look at her. Get a picture of Tammy Baldwin up.
Give she's me pretty. I know what she looks like. She's really hot.
Is she?
No, she's not.
Oh, my God.
Oh, God.
Oh, my God.
She looks like someone I know.
Yeah,
a guy.
She's fucking Jason Voorhees' mother.
I think...
Lick it, mommy. Lick it.
Oh, right.
All right. It's not,
Tammy Baldwin makes history.
Not bad there.
Yeah.
Good for Tammy.
Good for Tammy.
Go.
Whatever.
Go ahead. Human rights campaign she goes with. That's fucking wonderful.
And then we got some states legalizing marijuana.
Legalizing it or decriminalizing?
Colorado.
Colorado and Washington become the first two states in the country to legalize marijuana, but it's still banned at the federal level.
Yeah,
so the matter will have to be resolved in court. So
how can the federal level, that's what I don't understand, how can they override the states when it comes to that? Why do they have jurisdiction there?
I have no idea how or why that works like that. I don't know how states' rights can be trounced on at a federal level when it comes to marijuana. I mean,
if they say we want them to be able to smoke it here, the voters say that, why the fuck should the federal government have any say in it at all?
Yeah.
Especially in America.
In America!
The people have spoken. They want their marijuana.
Reverend Al is absolutely going with a Frederick Douglass haired. look at the back of his hair. Yes.
It's the feet of all that we care about. I mean, pretty frightening.
Yeah, you know what?
Oh, he's laughing. He's happy.
After anything.
I just love Chris Matthews.
Fucking Chris Matthews.
Because he's just
Did you see that his hair in the back is sticking up?
Like Dennis the Menace.
That guy's
going
a disaster area.
The Brian Regan of MSNBC. Hey. Massachusetts becomes the 18th state to approve the use of marijuana for medical purposes.
Wow.
Wow.
That's good.
Wow. Wow.
I don't mind that. I don't mind the pot thing either.
Wow.
Fucking smoke as much weed as you want. As long as booze is legal, any fucking drug should be legal.
You might need
booze
some pot
is
today.
Terrible.
Though. You might need some pot today.
No.
Just
no.
To chill you out.
It would get me too paranoid. I'd be sitting there going, oh my God, the president's a,
the biggest loser. Did we say this on air or off air? The biggest loser in the whole thing. I'll say it again if we did. The biggest loser by far is Vince McMahon.
Oh, yeah.
You his wife wasted $100 million in two campaigns. $100 million of Vince's money. Now, some would say, well, Linda, blah, blah, blah. No, WWE is Vince's company. He
it's
just
WWE
allowed
money.
He just allowed his wife to kind of get involved, and he gave her a good position in the company.
Yeah. Would you be mad if your wife's Vince's hobby cost $90 million?
Oh, my God.
Some say
yes.
100, but it's $90 to $100 million.
Stay tuned this year. We're going to have daily pay-per-views. Every day of the week, a brand new pay-per-view. I got to make my money back, goddammit. I got to make it up. Listen, all you wrestlers, you're going to be working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And that means you too, Stone Cold E.T.
Must be nice to have a wife that has a hobby that costs you $90 to $100 million. And what? The last 4 years, right?
It's like,
yeah,
why not go years. Into fucking, you know, flowers? Get a flower bed, Linda.
Holy
what
shit.
What hobby do you have? Gardening or fucking a quilting bee?
Did she get her ass kicked?
Destroyed.
In Connecticut?
Yep.
Annihilated.
Wasn't even close
not
again?
Even close.
Not even close.
So what? Vince just has like, that type of money to just fucking burn, huh?
It was close, like, weeks ago. Like, the polls and everything, they were like, oh, Linda might win this thing. And then I'm watching whatever channel I was watching last night, and immediately after the polls were closing, the first forecasts or whatever were like 89% to the
crazy.
Other guy.
It never changed.
So I guess wrestlers just don't vote, huh? You would think they would do the right thing and get together in Connecticut and help out Vince.
Well, yeah, I would assume
for all the pay-per-views and all the great fucking times.
I like if they ran. They all ran into the polling places and just started dropping elbows on the fucking people that were voting against her.
How many giant businesses are born in Connecticut? You'd think that Connecticut had some kind of WWE loyalty,
right?
Wow. Nothing. The McMahons are not the Connecticut royalty we thought they were.
The Connecticut McMahons are outcasts. Yes.
What do you think that household is like today?
Her consoling him. She's apologizing through the bedroom door. The only reason he gave her the money is she said the first thing she should do is pass legislation that says $90 million goes to all men whose names start with V. So he's like, all right, I'll loan you the money.
You know, to Vince, like, this was all part of his thing. Like, he was envisioning a time when Linda, because he can't do it because there's too much horrible tape of him, but maybe Linda could get ahead.
Yes.
And in his mind, the McMahons were going to take the White House one day.
Yeah. I had a whole different vision for you. A different vision. Senator McMahon. President McMahon. I didn't want this wrestling for you.
Like, he thought he was going to control the country through Linda.
Wow. I'm drinking more wine than I used to. Stop your spilling it.
Read the funny papers.
Why don't we do this? We got food in front of us. We got lots to do today, man. We got voters and why they voted.
Oh, no.
We got Karl Rove losing his fucking mind on
Karl
Fox.
Karl Rove, who was predicting a 300-plus electoral votes for Romney.
He's a hateable guy, Karl
Rove.
He is
an idiot.
What a douchebag.
MC Rove!
Right. What a douche.
Oh, that guy.
Remember that?
Of course. And then Diane Sawyer, a lot of people saying, very drunk last night as she was trying to broadcast the whole election thing. So, quick break and we'll continue.
Fucking take your cock and shove it up your pal's asshole. I don't care.
The Opie and Anthony Channel on Sirius XM.
And about me sounding like a white supremacist over the past week or so since Obama was elected, I'm seeing things that are happening outside. I'm experiencing things myself. This isn't my imagination. I am being bullied. That is just what's happening.
Come on. I've been listening on the radio to what's going down on the O&A show. Obama's got Anthony's thickest in a twist.
Yeah.
Something about the tanks
and the guns in his fist.
Wow.
Guessing the best, they're going to take Ann's guns away. Yeah. Robbing the rich for the black man's vanity. Wow. That's just crazy if you think for a sec.
Well, yeah.
Now why the fuck would I want Anthony's check unless I'm getting a Shelby, a chicken to smell me.
Wow.
Sweet radio show, yeah, that would sell me.
Yeah.
But am I getting paid? And
Obama president now.
That's right.
You're a high-profile radio host.
Dude, I can't take this anymore. I can't take it.
It's the United Negro Kumia Fund. A drink in every bed and under 21. So turn in your guns for the
college
brain.
Shut
the Starbucks for the great soda machine. Gonna get me a biotic depression in. And Anthony's gonna have to take it on the chin. I'm bumping in the crackers at Don't Steer Clear. It's the black man's time for terror and fear. Don't worry about the mortgage or paying your rent. Obama's got your back cause he's heaven sent. And when he's done improving my life, I'm gonna have more money than his ex-wife.
Joking. This is what we're dealing with. And in this country, you've been allowed to voice that opinion and then have a dialogue about it with other people who disagree with that opinion. That's great. It's a great thing. But we've gotten to this point where you can't do that anymore. Hey, Obama president, that's what the president's gonna do for you? Now you can walk in front of white people's cars. I'm sick of it.
You need a baby aspirin or something?
Shut the F up.
Blind, but now I see.
Obama president,
This is the Opie and Anthony Show.
Ha! I like this.
From Rocky.
Remember that? Which one was this? Rocky 3?
I think it was Rocky 8.
The Maverick. Was it 2? I think it was Rocky 2? Rocky 4? Rocky 3? Which one was this? He's working out. Living in
It was one of the later ones, obviously.
He's in the hotel, like, lobby. And he's working out. Wasn't
that this is with
three?
Dolph Lundgren.
Oh, was it 4?
I think it was
Drago?
4. I think it was the one where Rocky was down and out, and then, like, halfway through the movie, all of a sudden, like, the music kicks in, and he starts training. And Yeah. I think it was that one.
Oh, this is where Drago kills fucking Apollo Creed.
Sorry for the spoiler, people.
Yeah. What?
I will break you.
They're bringing Drago up in that elevated ring, and he's looking around at the decadence because he's so Soviet, and he's looking around at the decadence like, what the fuck is this? This
is
crazy.
I will break you.
And then Mission Impossible is still using this theme of the Russian, that fucking fake cornball Hollywood.
Oh, you finally saw it, huh?
Oh, I had seen it a while ago. No.
I was pissed off by that, too. I was like, what are you doing?
I saw it in the theater.
But they hinted. But did you notice how they hinted there might have been a Middle Eastern angle to it because they were in Dubai?
And I bet you that's why they didn't do it. I'll bet you that was funded partially by someone in Dubai. That's why they didn't show anybody technically falling out of that tower either.
Right.
Living
didn't want that.
In America.
Fucking cornball.
We got Karl Rove, and we got a news guy, Bertation, and we got Diane Sawyer. We want to get all this in, and then we're going to get Jay Moore on the program today.
Please.
So what do you want to do first? You want to do the Karl Rove?
Yeah, Karl Rove was predicting a Romney landslide with over 300 electoral votes. That did not come to be.
Karl Rove is a twat.
Karl Rove is an idiot.
He's just a hateable twat.
MC Rove!
Exactly.
Oh, and he's dancing around, rapping. Ugh.
We've had one instance where something was prematurely called.
You know it well.
They said this is not going to be another one of those.
Maybe not. Maybe
scenarios.
Not. But again, I just wonder when you're sitting there with 4.4 million votes cast, a difference of 991 votes between the two candidates. Wow. The difference is 49.19 to 49.17. If a little bit of caution might not be better until, if it's going to happen, let the votes begin to show it. Let the rest of Cayuga come in. Let some more Hamilton come in and start to see some of that separation. So you're validating it. Not doing what it seems to be very early.
Yeah, talk to Arnim Mishkin, Chris Steierwalt, Michael Barone's back there. They're
and
all Mishkin.
Very, and they're very smart guys. They're very smart guys. I'm just saying that in terms of public perception, it looks a little odd for us to be making a call with 991
votes. But you know how the science works. They know the counties and they know the expected outcome, the makeup of the remaining electorate.
And look, they've got a bigger data set than I do. But I'm sitting here saying I know Cayuga. Of those 258,000 votes, it's going to be 70-30 in all likelihood. But in the Hamilton ones, depending on what's left out, it could be 60-40 the other way.
They didn't seem to think it was going to be that much in Hamilton.
They're pretty confident that back there, Carl, but we'll keep on going back and forth.
What is that about? You think he really believes that? Because there is a science to this whole thing, and it gets very obvious how the counties are going to come
in. They know very quickly, based on a sample of what coming in on these counties, what the rest of the county's going to do.
So does he believe that?
He does.
Yeah. He does.
Yeah, yeah. This, he's delusional.
That clip was from 11:40, which was over 30 minutes after Fox declared Obama.
Even
was
Fox said, and you know they're going to hold out as long as they can, and he's still going, no. Oh, well, the next clip.
So then they go. Then they go to like the Fox decision room,
right?
And
now here are the guys. This is the decision desk. Now we're in the heart of the decision desk room.
Ooh,
Arnon, you head this place up. Chris Steierwalt, you've been doing all the number crunching. These guys behind, you tell me whether you stand by your call on Ohio, given the doubts Karl Rove just raised.
We're actually quite comfortable with the call in Ohio. Basically, right now there's too much Obama vote that's outstanding
and
there that
Fox.
We know is going to come in.
Yeah, this is Fox. They're explaining.
There's going to be Obama. And while, yes, there are a number of counties out there that will be Romney, the largest thing that's outstanding right now is the Cleveland area. It's Cuyahoga. This is Democratic territory, and we're quite comfortable with the idea that Obama will carry Ohio.
Wow.
What do you make of it, Chris?
There just aren't enough Republican votes left for Mitt Romney to get there. And as Arnon points out, Cuyahoga County, Cleveland is so overwhelmingly Democratic, we wouldn't expect Mitt Romney to do even much more than a third of the vote there. So as the late vote comes in, we would expect to see the president's margin rise and rise.
Wow.
They just know.
He just wouldn't let it go.
Oh, he wouldn't let it go.
And they just wouldn't let it go, huh?
And then MSNBC actually brought it up.
This is kind of amazing. I will say that the politics of this, MSNBC, not just the counting of this,
who's this guy?
Justin Bieber? Upon. I mean, what's happening on the right is that one of the on-air contributors at the Fox News channel is one of the single largest outside spenders in this race in favor of Mitt Romney, who is Karl Rove, who is now trying to get on air the Fox News channel to rescind its call in Ohio in favor of the candidate that he has bankrolled to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars. This is a remarkable thing.
This goes to the larger point that I'd been making quite a bit, which is that there is going to be a big chunk. I heard Steve talk about this. A big chunk of one of the two sides that was not going to believe they lost. There's more than just feeling aggrieved that they
chunk.
Lost.
It's Karl Rove.
They don't believe it. And I think you're going to have chunk of
everyone
the Republican
else knew.
Base that doesn't, they're not going to understand it. They've been told that the polls were skewed for weeks.
Oh, shut up. The truth of the matter is, if the Republicans won in a race that was exactly like this, only reversed, the Democrats would be screaming that it was fixed, there were problems, there was voter irregularity. They'd be screaming that because they're whining babies. You know, I think the Republicans knew last night that it was over. Not a large chunk of people saying, well, I think they're still going to pull it out. No, they knew. And you know what? There weren't riots. There weren't fucking people crying about ballads and hanging chads and fucking broken machines.
What's a hanging chad? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that little piece of paper. Chad.
Chad. Yeah, I was going to say, what did Chad do wrong? You know,
yeah.
Hanging with something.
He was hanging with something. Out. Yeah.
Shut up.
Well, can we go to the Bertation now?
Yeah, this.
Go to Deadspin.
Deadspin has it?
Yeah.
So the meat spin.
So what do you got? Local news in Michigan, I believe?
I think this is...
We got to get this one on our Facebook page. We love the Bertations.
Yeah, Michigan. I'm sorry. You're right.
Michigan. Local news. They're talking about the election, and this guy just fucking just stops talking. He doesn't even know where he is.
Just looks into the camera, and it is just a total fucking brain fart.
Opie and Anthony on Facebook. We'll have this clip.
Call anything.
Right now, it looks like all six proposals are headed for defeat. Proposal one, the referendum on the emergency. I'm sorry. Jeff, first of all, we talk about these proposals, how it's been trending toward.
They just look at him. They're looking at him like, what did you just do?
They're so annoying.
He's looking right at the camera. He's talking, and then he just stops and goes,
Can I hear that again?
I'm sorry.
Yeah, let's play that.
I wonder what went through his mind right then.
Right now, it looks like all six proposals are headed for defeat. Proposal one, the referendum on the emergency.
The guy starts laughing at him.
But neither of them just goes, hey, you all right?
Yeah, no,
what the fuck is wrong with these news people?
Yeah, why can't you have a real moment?
Hey, you okay?
Probably had somebody talking in his earpiece and just couldn't handle listening and talking.
Do you think
at the
that
same
was
time.
It?
You know what? Maybe it
kind of looked like he was distracted.
Because he leaned down and then he said, oh, I'm sorry. Like he was talking to the man in his earpiece.
Yeah.
But he wasn't acknowledging that nobody, he wasn't being a professional and acknowledging that nobody could hear the man in his ear.
You think it was one of the producers messing with him like we used to do to Steve?
you want one phone call, Ant?
All right. Whatever.
Just one guy. He's been listening to you for the last hour. Eric, what's up? Eric.
It's worse than our Eric.
Jesus, Eric.
That's not funny.
This idiot just waited 40 minutes.
He waited, and nothing.
Eric. We hear you. What could this guy possibly be doing?
Well, there he is.
Goodbye, Eric.
Way to go, Eric. 40 minutes for nothing.
Yep.
All right, and then we go to Diane Sawyer. A lot of people saying she was very,
a lot of people saying she was drunk, huh?
Yeah.
She appeared to be intoxicated.
And really?
There's kind of a montage of her coverage for what, ABC, I guess she works for?
Yes.
Is she thought to be a drinker? Like, I don't know.
I have no idea.
I'll be the judge of this.
All right.
Yes, the expert.
Watch closely.
Yeah. The broadcast was very compound-esque.
Oh, okay, great. Yes, drunk people sitting with graphics around them.
All right, hit it.
I want to give you a sense, though, of our election headquarters here. I want to show everybody what we have right now. Almost half of the voting. Fourth senior advisor David Axelrod worked in the White
House. And we know that the governor also has Lucky Milkshake. We've been spending a lot of time with these two candidates.
And we're
really up close and personal, David. And, of course, it's been long work days for people out west as they head in, some of them tugging their children along. But we have a projection to make without our music. We need our music. Many of you are tweeting us, and I love precision tweeting.
Wow, pause.
Precision social
media. She doesn't seem normal.
She's drunk.
She seems a little tipsy.
Or maybe on a pill. I don't know. I don't know what she's into, but that's not... There's something going on there. There's a slur. There's a slowness.
Yeah.
To her speech.
And the slouching that's happening,
yes.
too.
Yeah, she's leaning over.
On one hand.
To Stephanopoulos. She's like, yeah, doing that thing you do at a bar.
Why don't you show me that big Greek cock, honey? Take out that big Greek hunk of meat and stick it in my Tanner Boyle hairdo face.
My shitter, like you Greeks do.
Yeah, come on, you Greek. Why don't you fuck me where the Greeks...
Over to our headquarters and Katie Kurtz. That's right, and she has run so hard, so long, with so much money that we remind everyone how many people around the world die, literally die, for the right to do what we have all done today.
And drink at work.
Tonight,
wow.
As we said earlier, countries from Mexico to Britain, from India to
Indio.
Brazil.
Indio.
China is watching.
Indio, I need you so.
Designated to watch everything happening in this country tonight. And we got a wonderful tweet on why tonight matters, because somebody says, my grandparents made sure I would always be free because the whole world
is embarrassing.
I still remember the woman who went out and
the woman. Poor George Stephanopoulos feels like Opie did in 2000 doing a show.
The drunk woman.
I do think it's always interesting to imagine.
You never
being
slurred
in
like this, man.
I'm a good drunk.
Feeling the mood of the room.
Very functional.
See it. See if we can hear it. I have a question I wanted to ask, by the way. At one point,
they're laughing.
Obama's campaign put an exclamation point after forward. It was just forward, and then it had an exclamation point. When did they decide that was the right message for them?
Message.
And at the end of the day, as we're talking tonight, as these states, we may again be talking about the President Obama get out the vote machine, are projecting the battleground state of Ohio for President Barack Obama, which means you are looking at the President of the United States.
Who does she sound like? It's audio
she
we played
sound
on our
like
show.
Somebody.
Before.
Yeah, I can't figure it out.
That's the President of the United States.
I'm getting some intel. I don't know. Uh-huh. This guy, Krusty Whistle, says, I was embedded in the military with Diane Sawyer.
Oh, yeah?
And she is indeed a...
She likes...
According to this guy.
Likes to imbibe.
According to this guy, perhaps. A drinker.
I guess all newscasters drink.
Yeah, but what the fuck? Man?
News... People in the news industry, I've never seen a bigger group of drunks than the people that work in the news. It's amazing the amount of booze they can drink. Astounding.
Their job is literally to just sit there and, like, you know, after you do it for a couple years, you got it.
Yeah.
You're done.
Yeah.
You don't have to think at all anymore. So you could be drunk.
And the hours are really weird because you got to work for, like, a little while, and then you're off for a big stretch, but then you got to come back, and there's really nothing to do, so they just fucking drink.
Well, when we used to have more restaurants on the Upper West Side with the outdoor seating.
Yeah.
You would go, you're right, in between newscasts, you would see them outside having dinner, smoking cigars, having cocktails. In between the 6 and the 11.
You mean they weren't following leads and reporting?
No.
You know, you go home and have a couple of shooters.
Was there a Fox argument recently? Someone said there was a Fox argument recently, and I didn't between two anchors I thought was off the air.
Ooh.
And I
hot
tried
girls?
I wish.
Fox yeah. argument. Yeah. They're foxy.
Oh, it's funny. I heard there was an argument recently between two anchors.
Oh, we would have had the audio. That would have been viral, no?
I don't know.
There's an argument sound like between two anchors. Clang, clang.
Oh.
Clang. Anchors.
I understood it.
Thank you. Thank you.
I understood it.
I know what you meant.
Thank you to Jay from Huntington.
What up?
Frankie Blue.
Oh, yeah.
The famous Frankie Blue audio.
All right. Very
Thank
good.
Thank you, Jay from Huntington.
Yes.
It was hitting me when Diane Sawyer was talking. It's that Frankie Blue shit.
$10,000 grand prize.
We have to play Frankie Blue now.
Frankie
we
Blue.
We just have to do it. This guy was a massive programmer, and it just ruined his career. I don't even know where he is. The Frankie
wow.
Blue.
Yeah, where did Frankie Blue go?
We could actually play Frankie Blue in a break, and then we could get Jay Moore in here. But really fast, the bus driver from Cleveland.
Yeah.
Whose last name is Hughes, by the way.
Whoops.
One of my relatives, I guess.
You're fired.
We said he would get fired, right?
Yeah,
we said
so fired.
We
so
said
fired.
You just can't fucking uppercut a bitch and no. expect to fucking keep your job.
And there's another angle, too. It shows her assaulting him first.
Right, yeah, regardless yeah. of the fact that she was a real toot.
They said, the bus company said that he didn't fuck. What he should have done was pulled over and called the transit police or whatever.
Yeah, huh?
Or hold her down or something. The uppercut yeah. was a little too much for the bosses.
You just can't down. Uppercut a woman in the face.
Oh, man, she so deserved it. Pretty much.
She absolutely deserved
every
it.
Every person I've talked to has said that she deserved it.
Yeah.
So that guy got fired. I think we called that a while ago. That was a tough one to skate. And then we got the nor'easter we talked about, yeah. It's hitting today.
Yeah, so they say.
It's going to be a nightmare for Long Island.
Will it affect Friday? I'm flying to Toronto.
I don't think so.
We're all flying Friday.
Yeah, yeah.
You guys are going to L.A.?
Too.
I'm going to Toronto. I'm sold out.
Oh.
In Toronto?
Yes. Yeah, so
congratulations.
I'm not trying to, no, I'm not trying to plug. It was a festival.
That's
gig.
Awesome.
But we have a nice following in Canada.
We're going to L.A. to do a little something. We'll see how that works out.
Yeah. What's this L.A. trip?
It's going to be good.
I don't know.
I don't even know if they're allowed to say.
I don't know what it is.
I know what it is. I know what it is.
Mystery and intrigue behind this
it's
trip.
Some kind of fucking thing.
We're doing some TV, but I don't really know what.
I don't know.
I don't know what's going to happen.
We have no idea. I have no idea.
I'm going to see my old pal Jay and see how his kids are doing.
I'll hang out in a hotel and get room service.
Maybe
doing a television show in Hollywood.
Maybe run into our agent and have a boring dinner with him.
Oh, that is not.
He still texts my old number. Bob, you're still texting my. Why would I say that? He's not listening to the show?
No, he doesn't listen to the show.
I think we talked about it on the afternoon show, but have you picked up his calls?
No, still
since
not.
Your daughter was
no.
How old is your daughter?
She's over a month now,
and he's called
numerous
most days.
Yeah,
You haven't picked up then.
No, not yet.
No.
Okay. Hey, can we play that clip from that black chick from
yes.
Baton Rouge?
What happened?
That was being questioned about how she might vote.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, let's play this clip.
The audio
this is a black chick. From Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and she's being interviewed.
Okay.
By a guilty white journalist, I gather. But
well.
Oh, turn that up. Oh boy, what happened?
Jesus Christ, what did happen?
I didn't get my brother. You know, my brother called me. I'm like, well, I'm coming to meet you, and I'm gonna bring you here. Yeah. So, what's important to you? It's very important. It's very, very important that we vote. It is crucial. I can't stress that. It's very, very crucial that we get out and vote. Now, what race are you most interested in? Black. Is it the presidential? Is it the mayoral? Is it
Why didn't she call her out on it?
It's the presidential.
Presidential.
You know what, though? She did ask her, but she did clarify, is it presidential or is it mayoral?
When you say, what race are you most interested in? The fact that she said black, it's so telling for a large portion of the community that's just the most important part is the fact that he's black. Danny just told me, you know, he was at one of the, I guess, Burger King or something. And a couple of black chicks are talking to each other behind the counter, of course. And said, you know, did you vote last night? She's like, yeah. Who'd you vote for? Obama, of course. And Danny said, why? And then she gave him that look like what you think? Oh, because you're black, right, Danny?
Yeah. She gave me the only way to describe it is she gave me the
Please face.
Like, why you think I voted for
I said,
like,
I just
like
said,
who
why?
Could please?
Oh, yeah. Right. exactly. Right. Uh-huh. Because and the behind the counter, the aura was that, of course you voted for Obama, right? And the fact that, like, that's how she addressed me as a customer. Like, of course you vote. And I'm like, no. Yeah. She's like, how come? I'm like, what, are you kidding me? Like, why did you vote for Biden? And she just gave me this look. Like,
why you think?
Like, why you think?
Because you're black.
She's probably looking at you like that because you had a Burger King hat on with the little crowns.
No, they don't give those out during breakfast.
I know.
So this worked out so well, the Democrats should start grooming another black guy for the next election.
No, look, the Republicans should. The dumb Republicans.
You think they're going to go that route?
Can we get a white guy back in for the love of fuck?
But who cares? They don't have any good black candidates. They have zero black candidates.
You just made it. You just made her terrible for saying I voted for Obama because he was black and you're demanding guy back.
No.
It's different.
I'm saying she's just being dishonest.
Yeah.
And the news reporter wasn't calling her out on it.
And it's not masking it.
I'm not masking it. I want a white president.
You're hooding it.
I think a white yes, I'm hooding it. I think a white president would look after my best interest than a black president does. Sorry, it's just the way it is. That's why black people vote for the black guy. So, stop.
Oh, okay. So the Burger King thing was bad because they didn't specifically say.
Because if you just said, "Yeah, I'm voting for him because he's black," like I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Just say so.
If they asked her, "Why did you vote for Obama?" she'd come up with 20 fucking reasons to not say because he's black and I'm black because they're fucking phony. Phonies.
So what quality are you looking for in a president?
Anthony Cumia. I think a white guy would best suit my interests. And when you're catering mostly to 10% of the population, and a 10% that is there's a higher incidence of poverty and crime and whatnot, I don't think you really are addressing the demographic of the entire nation. I think you're pigeonholed into caring for a group of people that needs more attention than the general public of the country. Mm-hmm. And I don't think he's going to do a good job representing the entire country.
Are we going to do more of that clip or are we good? We're good with that clip?
That's the clip.
Yeah,
that was the
whole
clip?
Yeah, okay. That's her. That's her. Black.
All right, because we got to move along because we got Jay Moore waiting and we want to get to some other things, obviously. You want to play Frankie Blue into break?
All good.
You got him.
Frankie Blue, Christmas party, and then what happened?
He's having a Christmas party. They were doing a giveaway. He went in.
I know, but there was another jock, and she couldn't perform anymore, so Frankie Blue went on the air for her.
Filled in for her,
and he was just as fucked up, I guess.
He was hoping she took a hell of a piss.
Well, he was fucking doted.
They got into a fight, and he kicked her off.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, it was a whole thing. The Christmas party was pretty wild, obviously. So Frankie Blue said, I don't need you. I'm going on the air, and I'm doing your job now.
And Chip is right. Frankie Blue seemed like he was zooted at the time.
Can I make a radio observation, which will not help?
Yes.
But, Danny, you really look like Chef from Apocalypse Now.
Chef. Saucier.
All I'm thinking of is Danny's talking. I want someone to throw his head in my lap. Or Danny's head in Bob Kelly's lap.
It doesn't have to get thrown there. I'll just
gently place it there.
So we go to break with Frankie Blue, fucked up on the air. There you go.
Oh, that's
kind of
funny.
That's pretty fucked up.
That's pretty good.
That's pretty good, man.
Yeah. All that marbled meat, man. It was gray.
Fucking tiger, man.
I know, almost sounds like Anthony last night.
It's a fucking tiger. Fucking tiger.
Close.
Yes. This ruined Frankie Blue's radio career.
Yeah.
We go to break with this.
Mix 102.7. The new Mix 102.7. This is Frankie Blue. And I am so excited for tomorrow. I got Ricky and Rue coming in the morning, putting a hand in the big old barrel and picking out a $50,000 grand prize winner. The winner of the KTU Mix 102 Redo Contest. And also you win a Toyota Scion. Now what's going to happen is they're gonna put their hand in the barrel. They're gonna pick out a winner.
And then they're going to butt that winner. And that winner will be rewarded with everything. Mix 1027, Frankie Blue, what's happening? Good evening.
Sirius XM. This is the Opie and Anthony Show.
E-Rock wasn't here when Jay was in Monday, right? Because he's not playing his theme music.
Right.
I have theme music?
Yeah, you got the Van Halen, or we could have went with Run to the Hills.
The what? It needs an extra verse.
The one that needs an extra verse.
I will say this. The Opie and Anthony listeners really just...
The Opie and Anthony army?
The O&A army, man. The pests absolutely blew up Twitter after that show. That was good goddamn fun. Once Vedder and once Chip was touring with Pearl Jam.
Yes,
and Dolores was there because it was a very special night. That was really crazy.
They really enjoyed that.
And then I'm laying in bed for two nights, going, "Do I chase it?
I know.
Do I let it have it? You guys probably do it all the fucking time. Do you chase it? And I'm like, you know what? There should be like a telethon for Dolores's floor with all the celebrities getting together.
It was a great appearance, sir.
You need to call. Dolores needs a new goddamn floor. You can't keep bringing men in and asking her to lay down on her back to fix it every day, can you? That's too much manpower. Get her new floor. Chip, are you a goddamn silent partner?
Hey, how come you, Harvey Keitel, how come you not Harvey Kiask?
Good one, Chip.
I ask myself that all the time.
That's good.
The kid has a good point, Anthony.
That's good, Chip.
I ask myself that all the time with my pants down, crying.
He's hilarious.
Yeah, how come you with Carson in church? My mother didn't go for that scene.
Oh, man. That's
your mother doesn't go for much. And when she does, she's all in. She broke the goddamn floorboards. She broke the goddamn floor.
She didn't like what you said about Daryl Strawberry.
Well, it's Cal Daniels. That was Colin. God, every time I come in,
Colin,
I start trading guys.
Yes,
that's all right. What did you? are you a voter there, Jay Moore?
I was going to do an absentee ballot, but I was late on my absentee ballot, so I was not able to vote.
But in general,
not that
you
it
vote.
Matters
for
California,
my president.
Right?
Yeah, he just kind of fucking stormed Normandy on that one.
Yeah.
What do you think?
It is.
What do you think of the Obama thing?
I mean, it is what it is. I'm not. You know, I'm a big Chris Christie fan. I like my favorite presidents are Truman and Nixon, so I swing the gamut back and forth. I like Gavin Newsom, lieutenant governor in California.
Yeah,
but wasn't he the mayor of San Francisco one time or no?
Yeah,
he's fucking way too left for me.
Lefty.
Yeah,
fucking left Hollywood lefty.
You know why I like him?
Why?
Because he's a super Catholic and doesn't believe in gay marriage or abortion, but every time he votes, he puts his personal shit aside and votes for the people.
Oh, I didn't realize that. Okay.
So he's like completely anti-gay marriage, completely anti-abortion.
Oh,
and then
when
he goes to vote, he just puts his shit aside and votes.
Oh, there you go.
The
okay.
Bush administration wouldn't join the Kyoto Treaty, which is like this international thing. And he got the actual, somehow he got the city of San Francisco as a nation into the Kyoto Treaty. So the city of San Francisco is like the number one recycling, like, you know, mulch.
Of course they are.
They love their mulch.
They sure, you know what I mean?
They love their mulch.
Hi, guys. Time for mulching.
Mulch.
I think we're missing a letter.
Mulch.
Would you like to mulch?
Your dick smells like mulch.
It should if you're doing it right.
Yes,
hot garbage.
Yes,
sizzling and hot garbage.
Hot garbage. You want to be there with Otto?
Wow.
Oh, that was off mic. You said you want to do the podcast.
Oh,
someone else is there.
Maybe, yeah,
Otto's
do Otto.
He's doing it.
Yeah, I'm down.
I was supposed to do it last night, but I had to babysit the kids.
Hey, Joe DeRosa, and I fucking went a little bananas on him, how mixed up his brain is.
It's a little mixed up, huh?
A man with a vagina wants to beat him up, so he calls a woman with a dick for advice.
Right.
What happened?
He wants to beat him up.
That Buck Angel wanted to beat him up, so he calls Bailey J. to go, what do I do? Buck Angel. And I'm trying to explain to him, like, you could beat up Buck Angel. He goes, have you fucking seen that guy? I go, he has a fucking vagina, Joe.
It's a woman. It's a chick.
He goes, it's not a dude. It's not a woman. It's a dude. And he's showing me pictures. I go, all right. But if that guy says, come over here and eat my pussy, could you?
Oh.
And he goes, yes. I go, that's a woman.
Oh, no.
If you said, come over here and eat my pussy, what would happen? Your dick and balls would hit me in my eyes and stuff, right? That's because you're a man.
Oh, right.
You're a goddamn man. You're mixed up. Buck fight Angel, the look. Man with the vagina. Circle away from the power hand. Take the fight to the ground.
That Buck Angel's a unique Buck situation. Angel, yeah,
looks like Chappie.
That's
if you had to like be with Buck Angel or Bailey J. We've said this before. Like
everybody picks Bailey J. Right?
Yes,
Bailey
over J. most women.
Yeah, because
I don't know. That's
but
a
Bailey
rough call.
J's got a cock.
That's a rough call.
Says you
and Buck Angel. That's Buck Angel before the fucking.
Buck Angel like was hot.
Looks like Tiger Woods' wife.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Buck Angel was
I guess what bothers me
woman.
Is that he didn't go the full thing and get the, like, turn the vagina inside out and make, like, a little Robin's egg penis. Is he going to be on the Chip Telethon, Chip?
Who's that?
The Buck Angel.
No, I don't know what that is. That confuses me.
Does it?
Nah, my mother said, stop pulling your pud to that picture, Chip, or you're going to go to hell. Put your pecker away.
Yeah, DeRosa's whole thing was, I don't know if I touch Bailey J's penis, is it going to be like touching a hot oven? Like, hey.
Yeah, that's... Throw a hot oven in your mouth. Yes, Joe.
And I go, well, that's the only reason you would be with that person is like, if not now, when? You know what I mean? Like, here we are all alone in a hotel room with this friend. Right. I just stare at her boobs.
Why does Buck Angel want to beat up Joe? I didn't know that.
Joe and Florentine were in here shitting on Buck Angel once.
Yeah.
Were they?
Yep.
I think you were in Buffalo with Kenny December 28th.
Yes, I will be.
In Buffalo, yes. We got a guy that wants to get on Ant's ass about Obama.
All right, go ahead.
He's pissed.
A fresh take.
I know. But this actually, he's mad because you openly admit you want a white president.
All right.
I and just you stand
think
by that.
More in my best interest personally than a black person.
Let's go to Dave in Baltimore. And black sorry. Guy. Dave, what's up, buddy?
Yeah. Understand what Anthony's saying?
Dave.
Hi, Dave. What's up?
Yeah, you fuck. Yeah. I
already a favorite.
Tuned in because I knew you, and I'm waiting for Sean Hannity and Rush Limbaugh. I want to hear all that vitriol coming out of your voice.
Oh, yeah?
Why are you talking like that?
Because let me tell you something.
You went to college.
I'm an Obama supporter.
You what?
I know he a fuck that ain't done nothing for no black person.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? But the fact that all the white people had all this racist shit to say, and the fact that white people don't know how to separate a true black African from an African American.
He won.
African. So what?
He fucking won. Game over. You guys are in. You're in the club. Congrats. No. You made it. Congrats. Congratulations. You made it.
Hey, Dave, you got to keep in mind, he won Florida because of an older woman white vote
right.
at the end. They just steam piled in at the end.
There's no way.
You can't get whiter than Miami, than Dade County, Florida. Yeah.
There's not a systematic racism going
First of all,
on in this
stop
country
stop yelling
anymore.
At us, Dave. Jesus, yeah, we're all like mellow.
Jesus.
Just had a big joint. We're all relaxed.
Man, you're yelling like the Sandman just pulled someone off the stage at the Apollo.
I look in the corner. The Sandman is stretching. A light-skinned girl. She starts booing me. I look over there. The Sandman is stretching. Got him pregnant.
All right. Dave, what do you got to say?
Yeah,
now?
Why are you yelling? That's a good point by Jay
Moore. Do you go to College of Everest? Is that why you're yelling?
Why are you making it difficult?
I just love the fact that you're mad. That all white people are mad.
All white people aren't mad.
There's five.
You're an idiot. I'm not mad.
There's five white people in this room. There's one guy that's like upset about the
results.
I would
have rather had Romney in there. I'm not freaking out and burning my city down, much like if Romney had one.
You have a contract.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, believe me.
But Jay makes a good point. We got five white guys in studio. I would say one is mad.
Yeah. Overwhelmed with indifference.
One is mad.
Indifference.
It wouldn't make a difference no matter who's president. Don't you remember what...
And you know what? If Obama wasn't such a tax and spend Democrat, I would be genuinely happy he won. That's my only issue with Obama,
is that he's
a tax and spend Democrat.
You're a damn liar. That's not your only interest.
It really is.
Why are you talking like Cab Calloway?
Howdy, liar. No, why would I lie?
That was Jimmy Norton, by the way.
It's Jim. That's my only issue with Obama. Yeah, I've said that all along.
Why is Jimmy lying?
Why am I lying?
I hope Obama.
No, no, no. Why is Jimmy lying?
He didn't answer,
first of all,
Dave.
Why is Jimmy
why am
lying?
I lying?
Let's stay on the talking points.
And then you
Dave.
Can do the hope Obama.
Yeah, why yeah, am I yeah. lying by saying that?
Because I heard what you said about the fact that you want a white president.
I didn't
that's,
say that.
That's Jimmy.
You're
Anthony,
mixing us
you
up.
Idiot.
We don't all look alike. You're missing us up.
Come on, Daniels.
I'm Jim. Anthony said that.
What you said about a white president is really the secret desire of all white people.
No, Jim, this is idiotic.
Dave, Dave, stop.
That's
Dave.
That's idiotic.
Dave, you're being
Dave, listen
really
for a
stupid.
Second. You have 2 ears. Listen. Jim Norton said he would like Obama more if he was not a tax and spend Democrat. You said you're a liar. Why is that lying?
Because he thinks it's me.
Oh, no. Fair is fair.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Jim Why? Norton said he's a tax and spend Democrat. You called Jim Norton a liar. Why is that lying? Go.
Okay.
Hello.
Maybe I was wrong on that, but I'm
yes. What a jerk.
At least I can admit it. At least, can you admit it within yourself that if Romney had won, that you wouldn't be running around with sparklers in your hand?
I'd be a lot happier.
Man, this guy's completely missing the point. Anthony is openly admitting all,
I'd be happier
you're
if
saying.
Romney would have won. But the truth of the matter is, you're saying
shooting looters off your lawn.
That's, you're saying that's the secret.
With your
fucking,
drone in your yard.
The secret. Every white person wanted a white president. If that was the case, the white president would have won. You idiot. You dummy. It's fucking. It was put to an election. A lot of white people voted for Obama.
Let me tell you something, man.
All right.
First of all, I'm a Hebrew Israelite. Ain't nothing.
Rastafari. One of those. Original Hebrew. You know how we do, bro.
Wait, are you a fan of the show? How great is that? A Hebrew Israelite that listens to the Opie and Anthony show.
That's nice.
You are the only one.
These useless people that stand on the corner fucking pontificating revisionist history and bullshit.
All right, listen.
Yeah. It's always revisionist history.
It is revisionist history. You weren't princes and kings. You didn't have giant fucking buildings and fucking great infrastructure and machines and airplanes and shit. You had nothing. And still, Africa's a petri dish. Africa's a petri dish of poverty and disease.
How come you don't call it revisionist history?
Jay is tapped out. He doesn't have a contract.
I'm going to be at Governor's in Long Island.
See you later,
Jay. Saturday and Sunday.
How come that's not revisionist history? You a fuck.
What about Pearl Harbor?
You a fuck.
I a fuck.
Yeah, what about
you
wait,
a fuck.
What about Pearl Harbor, Dave?
What about Pearl Harbor?
Pearl Harbor. This is about Pearl Harbor. If you don't want to call it revisionist history, you don't mind bringing up the past when you're talking about what happened to Amaka in the past and how Amaka got so strong.
Who's Amaka?
When a black man want to talk about what the savages that white people have been to them, now we bring up.
Shut up.
You know what? That's not a bad point. Why? How come people get mad when you say black people complain about the past, but people are like, shut up, let it go. But no one gets mad when someone says, hey, you know, talking about American history, how we've been wrong. That's not a bad point.
You're not, but we're not fucking going over to Japan and smacking people in the face, but over Pearl Harbor. That shit's ancient history.
Because you nuked and bombed the shit out of them.
Yeah, okay. So, get all your Africans together, build a nuke, and fucking pay us back for our slavery. What do you want from me?
That's coming.
You think it is? You want a revolution, fucker? 10% of the population. Bring it!
Okay, and check this out.
You've got to be dialing. If you want to nuke the United States from Africa, you got to call now.
What a dumb bunch of people thinking 10% of the population can overthrow the fucking country.
It's only one guy.
Stop it.
Nuclear warhead right out of Uganda.
What? First of all, you hold your gun sideways so you can't aim. Secondly, you never clean the fucking things so they jam constantly. Thirdly, you'd be taking out all your own people. With your fucking scatter fire. You people can't shoot. Go to the range. At least learn to shoot each other right. Don't hit grandma or the kid at the playground, you fuckers. Go to the shooting range. Practice. Hold the gun straight. How about this way? Hold the gun straight and turn the phone sideways when you take video. Jesus Christ.
Dave, that was a good one.
Yeah, he's not listening.
Dave, right. You got to listen a little too.
Dave's on hold. We can
Dave,
go back to
stay
him.
Can I ask Dave?
Steve is pissed off, though. He's a black guy from Houston.
Yes.
And he's saying that guy does not represent
sorry.
Black people.
I'm sorry, that's horrible.
Steve in Houston.
Hey, how you doing, fellas?
Well, you got Jeremy Lin, you motherfuckers.
You,
Fuck Jeremy Lin. I'm so
I like
tired
the Jeremy Lin. He's having a good season
like
so far.
Pussy loose. Fucking Jeremy Lin. The guy had 30 games.
He had a triple double pretty much the other night.
Every Nick
he had 21 points.
You've got to be dialing if you want to take over this country. Black people, get on that phone and
it's
give me a call.
A Lin Sanity jersey. Lin Sanity, complete with a soy sauce stain.
Everybody says the problem with the Knicks is the problem with the Knicks is they always get these awful extensions. They always and then the one time they don't extend the contract, everybody goes, "Oh, how do you not extend that guy? Pick a lane, Knicks fan."
Wait, so this
well,
guy
we wanted Jeremy Lin to stay.
This guy
brought
like,
a lot of excitement.
This guy disagrees with the black Israelite.
Steve in Houston.
I wonder how they would interact together.
Oh, that's true.
Well, the other guy, I did say.
Did Dave hang up?
Yeah, he did.
Oh, you should, Dave, you should have stayed.
I did
on
not
home.
Hang up on him. I wanted to go back to him, but
we wanted you to argue.
Go ahead, Steve in Houston.
Okay, it was just so much going on with Jay Moore. That's going to be in governors. But anyway.
Attaboy. Have that a sir.
I think what the guy was trying to say, mm-hmm. I think what he was trying to say is that, Anthony, you made such a point of how black people are voting for Obama just because he's black. But you need to point out the fact that a lot of white people are not voting for him because he's black. And that's the simple reason.
And enough voted for him to put him in office.
He cured cancer, and you would still not... And you would still find something wrong with the guy.
Well, wait, no, I think that would get true.
That would get Anthony's
that's
vote.
That's a pretty good one right there. But the fact of the matter is, his four-year record was not enough for me to go, wow, this guy needs another 4 years. I would have rather had a businessman in there during this horrid economy that maybe he could have done a better job. But white people put Obama in office, so there isn't this this fucking systematic institutional racism going on in this country anymore. And black people got to realize that. There's always going to be individual racism and shit like that.
Agreed.
There's not this systematic racism keeping the black man down anymore. So I'm not going to put up with it anymore. I'm going to speak my mind. I'm going to fucking say things. I'll fucking, you know, it's a fair game now. We're all on equal footing, people. You made it.
Equal footing. Not quite there yet. But
yes, you are, you fucking piece of shit. Yes, you are. You're on equal footing. There's nothing as a black man you cannot achieve that a white man can't achieve. Stop with the excuses. Stop it.
No, Anthony, by all means, I've never made an excuse. I went to graduate school, undergrad. I did the engineering route.
Yep.
I challenged. I came from a good family.
Good for you.
I don't make excuses. But I'm letting you know, as an American professional, they always, when I walk through the room, judge me based on that first. And I have to receive and perform.
Everyone gets judged like that.
And that's fine. I can accept that.
Everyone gets judged like that, and everyone's got to perform. Let me tell you something. When I got into the business of radio, I was put in there as a fucking sheet metal worker that didn't know shit about radio. Hold the phone.
And how could you hear what he's saying if you're talking?
I had to perform, and I had to make it work. For me to keep that job. I didn't keep it because I'm white or Italian or any other thing. It was my talents and whatever I had that allowed me to continue doing this job. Black people, same fucking thing. You're going to be judged on what you do. There is not institutional racism in America anymore. Stop with the fucking excuses. Holy shit.
All right, listen.
I'm sorry. And but once again, Anthony, we're on the same accord. I agree with you. I believe that a lot of black people, they focus on the wrong thing. They make their excuses.
Yes.
I'm very conservative in my views.
Oh, good.
Very conservative. But I just feel like you're the point that the gentleman was trying to make is that you made such a huge stand on so many black people voting for Obama because he's black. But we equally have that the racism and white was like, I'm not voting for that nigga.
Just
point blank.
Yeah, it's okay. I say it all the time.
There was a lot of that happening.
What he's saying is completely true.
It's true.
Half of white people will not vote for him simply because he's black.
Not true.
That is true.
Not true.
You're right. Don't go crazy on me.
There are people, but not half the fucking white people in the country.
I made that number.
How about the people that? How about the people that don't like what he did as president or the lack thereof?
How about 99% of the black people voting for him? You won't even meet me on what I just said. That half of white people won't vote for him because
not half.
Maybe not half, but even if it's 20%,
a third.
Even if it's 20%, that's still 40 million, or that's still 30 million.
million people. That's a
lot maybe
people.
Those people, but does it have to be racism, or does it have to be the fact that I think a white president best represents the majority of the country?
Well, is it racism when blacks only vote for Obama? You said yes.
But based on his record of impoverishing black people and keeping unemployment at 14.5% and fucking giving them
I voted for Pat Paulson.
But you just said a white president would better benefit you, not necessarily Romney.
But black president isn't better benefiting the black people.
No,
think about the heartache.
You're saying the same thing. It's the same thing.
No, it's not.
I'm just saying.
But you don't think...
I can only speak for myself. I know his views and financial policies do not benefit me at all, nor my wife.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I get no... Wife. I get raped from interest that I pay on... student loans or med school, everything.
Where'd you go to college?
Texas A&M undergrad, Tulane grad school.
But nice. Texas, yeah. The whole time.
Look at that.
My man putting in work. I dig it.
And do you believe there are a lot of white people that did not vote for Obama because he's black? For the simple fact that he's black.
Not simply based on racism. No.
No.
And that's you're too smart to have that stance.
Nope.
You're too intelligent a guy to just not even meet us there.
Well, do you think people voted for Obama that were white because of white guilt?
Some, sure.
Yeah.
Same. Some. And there was some that were racist. A finite number compared to the amount of people that didn't vote for him because he's black.
There's absolutely a lot of white people that didn't vote for him because he's black.
Who gives a shit? The motherfucker got in twice.
We're not saying who gives a shit. We're saying at least...
He got in twice. Stop it. There's gonna
be how the fuck did I get on the stop it list with you?
There's gonna be racism.
What the fuck did I do?
There's gonna be
say one thing.
Individual racism in
you
this
changed,
country.
Man.
No, I didn't. I've always been this
I'm
guy.
I'm just being a jerk.
But there's individual racism.
But you really don't think white people didn't vote for Obama?
Yes, of course they were.
Because he's black?
There were, yes, but I'm not saying.
I think it's a big number too.
Nope. Not based on racism, black.
Well,
based all right, on
what percentage you think?
I don't think they think
what percentage?
He would represent
not,
them.
Not, but it's not racism in a hateful way. This weird racism is, it's like, you said something honest. I think that a white president would better benefit me. You're not saying in that moment, I hate blacks. You're saying, I think my
not
guy
in that
would do a better job for me. So blacks are looking at it the same way, like, you know what? I think that guy, my guy, would do a better job for me. It's not always based
proven,
in racial
but
hatred.
But he's proven that he hasn't in 4 years. So you're not voting on his record.
But they may not feel that they're going to do any better under, like, George Bush or Mitt Romney. Black people may not feel like, hey, at least it's our guy we're not doing as well. And they, you know, it's like people probably aren't looking at it like... It's not like under Bush, things were amazing, and then they fell into the toilet, and then they're going, we're not voting for this guy because he's white. It was like, if things have stayed the same, why wouldn't they
if
just...
If there was a black Republican president... And a white Democratic candidate, and the black Republican president put in policies that were going to help me, tax-wise and whatnot, I would vote for him.
Yes.
I would vote for him.
Yeah, I get it. You're
I'm not just
going to Republican.
Vote, but black
but we
people,
all know people
are only
wait, you're,
voting.
Hold you're on. A Republican?
Yeah.
Oh, God, yeah. We,
Sorry.
A little slow today. But we all know white people that... didn't vote for Obama because he's a black guy.
Absolutely. Why do Republicans have no black candidates at all?
But they
zero. Yeah. No interesting black candidates. Fucking Herman Cain is the
we
best they
get
offer?
Her away from that guy.
What happened?
Oh, sorry.
But there's no black... The blacks were not voting for Romney because he was white. There are plenty of blacks...
Matter.
There are plenty of blacks that would have benefited from Romney... being elected president, but they didn't vote for him based purely on race.
Okay, let me ask you this. Will it come out the percentage of blacks that voted for Obama over Romney? Will we get that number?
Sure, I'm sure that'll come
down
through.
The road a little bit.
Yeah, sure.
It's probably 95% at least.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's a massive number. Yeah.
If a black guy or woman was going out to vote, they were going out to vote for Obama.
I'm saying,
a woman president.
Oof. Why didn't the Republicans take somebody like Condoleezza Rice as a VP or somebody? Why don't they fucking think differently and balance
Rice.
That out? They're dummies. The Republicans are fucking dummies. They blew it. They blew it with McCain by letting that dumb cunt from Alaska in.
Jesus.
They have done nothing but blow it. And they have nobody but themselves to blame.
No, they do have somebody else to blame.
You know?
The fucking media that was campaigning for
Obama
two fucking
That's
years.
Part
for 4 years.
Of it,
they campaigned. They licked his ass. They didn't call him out on things.
That's true.
Fucking Benghazi just slipped on by.
That's true,
Benghazi.
But Romney fucked himself.
And Gazzara.
Romney fucked himself by having that dumb audio leak out. It's like, do you understand how many people look at that and are going to fucking hear that and say, what are you doing?
Oh, that would have been nice to have the audio leak out of Obama not calling the terrorist act a terrorist act.
Or the fact that he said, I'm all for distribution of wealth. I mean, there's a lot of things Obama said that the media didn't push out.
I think your point is a higher percentage of blacks.
I think the point
Obama
is coming out of the top of Jimmy's head.
But all I want to throw into the argument, there were absolutely white people that didn't vote for Obama because he's a black guy.
I
agree with you that the percentage was way higher with the black vote. Yes, I do agree with you on that.
Oh, but what about the brown vote? Nobody's even talking about the Latinos.
Well, the Latinos put him over the top.
They did, right?
Yeah, in a lot of states.
There's more Latinos today than there were last night.
They gave him a lot.
They just keep going.
Ronnie got more Cubans, I think, than fucking Obama.
Cubans. Let's go. Cubans, you nutnik.
Let's go to Naomi, black woman, Texas.
Oh my God! Here they come,
Naomi.
Yes. Hello. Hello.
Hello.
Testing 1, 2, right?
Yeah.
What up?
Well, I believe there is some racism, but it's a whole lot of black people that just didn't vote for him either because they didn't want Obama to be the token nigga.
Really?
Yeah.
What kind of phone are you on? I think that's our phone. It's the second call in a row that's had that.
It was like this yesterday, but why took the phone?
So you're saying that a lot of blacks didn't want him to seem like a one-time token, like, hey, we got him in.
Well, the thing is, we have our first black president, and this is who's going to represent us as a whole.
A whole?
It's a whole lot, a whole general.
Yeah. Black. How about you use the L? Holy shit. Black people love leaving the L's out.
That can be seen as a little racist.
Oh, no, it is. It's a black dialect, I guess.
Oh, my God.
The contract.
What? We're going to talk about Planet Earth.
It's fair game. Planet Earth
is my place of birth. All right? So, wait, what are you saying?
Yeah, what are you saying?
Yeah, what are you saying?
What are you saying, dear?
What I'm saying is, I didn't want to vote for Obama the first time. But they put that joke over McCain and had that idiot Sarah Palin going with him. And so he fucked with that.
Did you think McCain was bad, though, or just Sarah Palin? I thought McCain, I thought he was a good man.
Well, no.
Sarah Palin, I thought, hurt him.
Well, the Sarah Palin was the problem there.
McCain always looked like he was walking across very cold water. He was had his hands up and a weird look on his face. Like, ugh.
We were in the military. Both my husband and I were in the military. And he has this prisoner of war mentality. We didn't want to go back, so we weren't going to put him in. But
what's a prisoner of war mentality? Be quiet and they give me rice?
No, I feel like he would have put him back overseas as far as keeping people in war.
Yeah.
All right, Naomi.
You got to be aware of the military-industrial complex, right?
Thank you to Naomi. We got a Hispanic guy.
Texas, where Governor Connolly got shot with that other one. They call it a magic bullet. I bet Governor Connolly didn't think that bullet was very magical, you know? Hit the guy fucking 3 times. What's magical about that? He probably called it the unlucky bullet. You think he's walking around the house going, has anybody seen my lucky bullet? The one that made a goddamn U-turn underneath my ribcage. Hit my sternum and said, which way's north? That's for Anthony. Trying to lighten this up, you fucking...
Of course. Sudden,
goddamn Hannity and Combs in here. Emphasis on Hannity.
No kidding. Roger says he's Hispanic and didn't vote for Romney because...
That's great,
cause
Robert.
Because he's white.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Can we hear him? Is he on?
That shit absolutely is happening all over the place.
Brooke Shields' mother died.
Hello.
Aw.
Roger!
Put her in Pretty Baby. Yeah. What could go wrong?
No, I didn't vote for Romney because he is white. How many black presidents have we ever had?
You're a gay Puerto Rican, man. I'm going to guess one.
Yeah, we can figure that out pretty easily.
But, yeah, I've had enough with the old white man.
Yeah, because it's really done the country so bad, having old white men run it for a fucking couple of hundred years and build it into what it is, and watching one black president pretty much dismantle it. Nice.
Well, nobody dismantled anything yet.
Well, we'll see. Enough has been put in place where I'm getting kind of an inkling of what the next 4 years is going to bring.
Wait, you can't say you've had enough, but he hasn't dismantled anything yet. That means you liked the place the country was at.
There goes the chip benefits.
Him.
The country has had nobody else represent what this country stands for, which means being the black president, he's the only one so far that's overcome what's going on. And so now we're like, okay, you know what? He's had 4 years. He he's had enough. Let's put somebody else back in.
Why don't you just put him in a powdered wig? Get back to the good old days, you know?
No, I'm
nice
not saying.
Nice little ponytail with a bow in it.
He won. He won. How are black people calling up and Hispanic people calling up and giving me shit? He won. Stop. No more excuses. I'm done with excuses.
I've not said that that we've had enough of you, Anthony. Come on.
Of course not.
You're fucking a third of the show already.
No one has enough of me. I'm magical.
All right, thank you.
Anthony makes a good point about the magic.
Wants to have that.
A lot of bullets.
All right, Roger. Thank you, Roger.
All right.
Phones are like a little rough right now, anyway.
Yeah, they sound awful. I'm sure the app is still not working.
Uh-oh.
Hey, I'm a black guy. Anthony, I think you're wrong. Hey, I'm a white guy. I think Anthony's right.
There you go.
Way to, you know, really split it up, you guys.
This nation is very divided.
There's another black guy who thinks Anthony's wrong.
Very divided nation.
Now we got a black guy that thinks Ant's right. How about that?
All right.
How about that, Conquin?
David from Irvington.
Let's go to North Carolina. This is...
you rabble around. What do you think a black guy? Jesse Helmstedt. A black guy's going to step out of line, speak his mind? Please.
This is Isaiah.
He lives 100 miles from Lynchburg, Virginia.
Isaiah.
Hey, what's up, man?
Hey, I just wanted to say, I think, Anthony, I think you're absolutely right, man. Oh.
Yeah, but how black are you?
You sound pretty white.
Yeah.
Like Malcolm Jamal Warner with like a pierced tongue and everything.
But I still like, you know, I've been around African Americans and I know my real parents. And my actual parents didn't vote for Obama either. So I think that you know, Mitt Romney would have been a good candidate.
You're a nervous wreck.
What'd you say?
I said you were a nervous wreck. Why don't you take a few deep breaths?
Yeah, what's your point?
I'm walking around.
Well, yeah, of course
well, how
you
about
are.
You stop?
Because if you stand still in North Carolina, they'll get to you. He's no dummy. Keeps it on the move. Every time he sits still, he goes, you know, my parents all voted for Romney.
You guys are a riot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Isaiah, what's your point?
What's my point?
Yeah.
It's coming out the top of your head.
Are equal.
Go to that well all day.
But I think that that the people who I think that when you vote, you should vote on principle and not just because somebody's black.
Completely agree. Right. But unfortunately, that's not what happens in elections.
Yeah, I know. But I'm just saying that because the last guy who called in before the other two was like completely irate, and I think that's just completely unnecessary too.
Yeah, but he was being honest. I mean, race has always been a big part of this country. It still is. It always has been, no matter how we look at it or policies, the feelings of race, it's always been something really prevalent in our thinking, but it's something we never really talk about, or we talk about in a back way, or we know people are not, you know, at least, and I'll say there's times I don't agree with you, but you're a fucking honest guy. You speak your mind. Some of these guys call in and speak their mind. Most people don't do that.
I like an open dialogue like that. It's
most
fine.
People are phony.
I don't care if people disagree and shit like that.
Yeah, but if
it's,
you won't admit that white people didn't vote for Obama just because he's black.
Some,
what's
right.
Some to you?
I don't have percentages. What do you think? I don't fucking percentages on that amount of people?
How much, though, you think? What percentage?
I'm asking you
20? 20%?
I would say.
What would your percentage be?
A guess based on nothing.
Okay.
20%. Which not based on the fact that fuck him because he's black, but I don't believe he's going to represent
Dolores
me
country.
Best being a black guy. I don't think he's got my best interest, and I don't think he actually has the best interest of the nation as a whole in his presidency.
Saying,
I really don't.
But saying he doesn't have my best interest in heart, meaning as a white guy, isn't that the same as saying I'm not going to vote for him because he's black?
No.
Couldn't black people be saying the same thing about Obama? It's not fuck white people, but I don't feel that a white guy has my best interest in. I feel that a black guy does.
I could understand that when they were electing him for the first term because, you know, the first black president, you're all going to whoop-de-doo and get behind it. I understand that. It's a benchmark moment, a history-making moment. But based on the past 4 years and what the position black people are in now economically— why would you vote this guy in again? He's done nothing but decimate you economically. I'm talking about the black community. But they vote for him just because he's black, not because... if Obama was talking about everything I wanted and proved it in 4 years, that I'm like, wow, he cut taxes, the deficit's down, the military's strong, he's there, I would vote for him. I wouldn't just vote along party lines. And I'm not kidding you. I'm not just saying that.
I would have voted for him. But there's no, that's a fucking, you might as well have a unicorn.
Then Romney
wasn't going to happen.
Romney should have been more of a moderate, which is what he is. And I, as a guy who does not dislike Mitt Romney, I felt like I know nothing about this fucking guy. I felt like he was a wishy-washy twat, and it annoyed me. It was like, just be the moderate guy you are. You, Romney Care got passed, and don't just fucking try to appease the extreme right side of the party.
You don't
need to do that. What do you think, they're going to vote for Obama over you, you dope?
Yeah.
He annoyed me with that.
Let's say hi to Patricia in Pittsburgh. Patricia.
Hey.
Hey.
Hey, I'm white, but I've always worked with a lot of black people. Like,
what are you, corrections officer?
Three guys broke their rib cages, squeezed through the same door just now. Jimmy squeaked it up.
I work in the mental health field. I got to tell you, over the past couple weeks, all I've heard is, give a brother a chance. Come on, give a brother a chance. Most certainly, there are tons of black people who just voted for Obama because he's black. Yeah. I don't know if that's racism or not. I mean, I voted for Hillary back when it was between Barack and Hillary. I voted for Hillary because she was a woman.
Yeah, people do that all the time.
People will do
that. Whether it's a woman, a white guy, black guy.
I don't understand why
people think he's the same religion as them.
We're so above the animal kingdom on this planet. We're just part of it.
That was Barack Obama during the debate. Ask me about the debt ceiling, Anthony.
How about the debt ceiling?
This guy wears magic underpants. That's what I think about the debt ceiling. The guy next to me has magic underpants on. The guy thinks that Native Americans are Jewish, you know?
All right. Thank you, Patricia.
She's Louise.
We got the Chris Matthews clip.
If Sam wasn't here, it'd be a completely quiet room.
All right. This is the Chris Matthews clip of him saying something about the hurricane,
yes.
Sandy,
the
devastation.
He believes the hurricane had something to do with this election.
All right. Let's hear his exact words. I want to hear his exact words instead of people tweeting.
But the superstorm hit a lot of states that were already Obama.
Yeah, but Obama was on national television.
With Christie.
Oh, it knocked down, Romney's voice for a while. You're right.
That turncoat fatty Christie.
Hey, watch us.
Fuck him. Fuck him.
Fuck him how?
Crying as he's fucking hugging Bruce. How did Bruce get his hands around that big fat fuck?
But I like
Bruce.
I
like him more now.
I like Bruce for doing that. I think we need more of that.
He plays long. He plays tall. He's like Tayshaun Prince.
So what did
doesn't look that long, but he plays long.
What's his name say? You don't respect Christie for doing that?
I know it.
He doesn't look good within his own party for doing that, but he knew at the time it was the right thing to do.
I'm just fucking around. I know he had to do what's best for
Jersey. Governor Christie in Twitter, man. They fucking hate him for doing that.
Yeah, I know.
They fucking hate him, but he knew for his state that was the right thing to do.
I know he needed it. And the fact is, he didn't need to do it. Because the president should have been there with all the fucking support. You don't need a governor to go in there begging for federal funds for a fucking disaster. Right. But I understand his point.
He's a bit emotional.
They made that fucking Atlantic City mayor, by the way. Sorry, Hope. They made him sit out when him and Christie toured fucking Jersey. That Atlantic City mayor sat in the airplane hangar for 4 hours, and Obama gave him 2 minutes.
Wow.
Obama gave him nothing. He was furious at that guy. So Obama kind of crossed party lines, too. He didn't give that guy a fucking thing.
It might also be Katrina, the local government, was so screwy, and it took so long for the feds to get involved. And I think Obama just stepped off the plane and said, who's in charge here? Ain't you?
Yeah.
Ain't you?
Well, here's Chris Matthews talking about the superstorm.
All right, let's hear this. Well, let me just close my thoughts tonight.
Please.
It takes a half a second. I am so proud of the country to reelect this president and overcoming, not because of the partisanship or any of the, even the policies, just the fact, here's an African guy, African-American guy from unusual.
God, he's got to bring it up.
He just does, yeah.
What? Enough.
What happened?
African guy. Chris Matthews.
That startled me.
Guiltiest white guy in the world. Guiltiest white guy in the world. I would love for Chris Matthews to be walking down the street and get one of those closed circuit fucking security cam views of four black guys punching him in the face and stomping on his head and stealing his wallet.
Look at Ohio.
Yeah.
The blue rose to the top in that state. Wow.
I have to tinkle desperately.
Oh, what? Oh, what happened? I have to piss badly. Jimmy.
I want to hear Chris Matthews.
Okay.
Even the policies, just the fact, here's an African guy, African-American guy from an unusual background.
No, African.
Part immigrant background, part African-American background, with all this assault on him from day one, from Mitch McConnell, from the clowns out there that aren't elected, never will be to anything. And the way he took it, as somebody said, with coolness and charm and dignity, and just took it and kept moving forward and doing his job. And the American people, and I know we look at these percentages, 40% of the white vote, fine, that's about right. fight among Democrats the last couple of cycles, three cycles or four. Good work for them. Good work for him. A good day for America. I'm so glad we had that storm last week, because I think the storm was one of those things. No, politically, I should say, not in terms of hurting people.
Fuck
the storm
you.
Brought in possibilities for good politics.
I'm so glad we had that storm last week.
Chris. Radio guys get fired for that
Fired. Bob Grant said about fucking, but call me an optimist, about Ron Brown possibly being killed in a fucking plane crash, and he was fired. And Chris Matthews, Imus says nappy-headed hose, he's fired. This guy says, I'm glad there was a storm last week.
I don't care if he tried to fix it by saying politically.
100 people dead in that storm.
Plus all the people that their lives are completely destroyed.
Well, what if Ron Brown said nappy-headed hose?
Would
he switch it all around?
Chris Matthews, there should be a fucking outcry about this. Where's the outrage?
You can't
won't be, because he's a lefty cunt.
You can't quickly just say, I mean, politically.
No. He is happy. That honesty came out of there.
Of course.
He was absolutely glad that that hurricane happened.
You should come to Governor's this weekend and see Jay Moore.
I really should.
He's doing a good job. He's right in your neighborhood.
Governor's.
Across from Bulls.
Levittown. Yes.
Colin Quinn?
Yeah.
No, you guys sound like you're really working ahead of steam this morning.
Hey, Colin, how are you? You can't unring this bell, Colin.
Colin, what's your take on the election?
Wait, we have Colin in studio. I'm confused.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Which Colin is the real one?
You really let the horse out of the barn, Anthony.
That's sick.
You're sick. Tell me I'm sick. Return a text.
Colin,
I love it.
What do you think of the election, Colin?
What do I think of it?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, you know, look, Romney shouldn't have, he shouldn't have been going, you know, changing his opinions halfway through.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
You think that would have made any difference in this environment?
Romney should have went on stage with RZA.
I think the American people, no matter what, are determined to prove they're not racist.
Stop giggling. Be a professional, for crying out loud.
You know what I'm saying?
Stop talking like that. You know what I'm saying. Yes, do I have a head injury that nobody told me about? Why wouldn't we know what you're saying? You just had a simple, salient point. Yes.
Even I know it's a good impression.
You better.
It really is. Holy fuck!
I'm going to your stomping. I know you.
Scary about it.
I know. Sorry.
I got my breathing down.
it's throwing Colin off.
I know we just moved, right? We just had a big move. We went downtown, keeping it real.
I moved downtown right before the storm hit.
No kidding.
Oh, good move.
Yeah.
Unlike Chris Matthews, I'm not very happy about the storm.
No, Chris Matthews seems to be ecstatic that there was a big storm, a deadly
storm.
Perfect
timing for the deadly storm.
Yeah, yeah.
He really is unbelievably dumb.
What a fucking unthought-out cock.
You know, and he used to be a speechwriter or something. You guys are unbelievable.
He used to work for Tip O'Neill when Tip O'Neill was Speaker of the House, you know?
Oh, my God, yeah.
He worked for Tip O'Neill, and then, you know, he does that Chris Matthews show. I was supposed to go on it, but he got malaria somehow. The only guy I've ever known that lives in Connecticut, who comes down with malaria. I think maybe he just didn't want me on a show.
I used to be a room service waiter at the Hilton at the Democratic Convention of 1980, not that I'm old, and I had to serve Tip O'Neill all his liquor all the time, and we used to call him No Tip O'Neill because he's never tip us.
Oh, as Jimmy would say, he was a real skinflint.
He really was.
That's when John Anderson ran, got 8% of the vote. You would have won if he put the glasses on and people thought he was Phil Donahue.
I wish you worked for room service when Dom DeLuise was in the hotel.
Well, I'd have a less boring story than
the one I did. No tip, O'Neill, and I like how you explained it.
I still don't get it.
I knew it when I got a call. Calling the show, and I knew I was going to bring it to a grinding halt. But I figured, you know, for the fraternity, I'd call up. But I knew I was going to bring it to a grinding halt.
What fraternity? You never even had to pledge.
I can't even understand.
You should, if you're going to be in the fraternity, you have to pledge. You should be walking around Manhattan with big cherries in your ass. Hi, I'm Colin. I'm a nudnik. I almost slipped. Oh. That was like George Dudley doing an impression of somebody.
Yeah. I hope
I hope I'm taking the weight, and the show's only sort of distinct since I get on this goddamn call, because it's been like this all morning. I swear to God, you guys are in trouble.
Yeah.
No. Oh.
Yeah. I tell you what, why don't we get a hold of Rich Voss? We can, you know, add some levity to the room. We were talking about Pearl Harbor earlier, so Colin, so it's a good thing you called up. More bombing.
Oh, shit.
See, I had to explain that one.
Colin, I got it, believe me.
Yeah. Yeah, Colin, your joke went over like a bunch of lead balloons or something, yeah. You know?
Oh.
Colin hates Chip. I don't get it.
Oh, Chip stinks.
Colin, we're going to have a benefit later. All the celebrities are going to get together to have a telethon for Chip. the other day, Eddie Vedder, we found out that Chip toured with Pearl Jam. Because his mother, Dolores, was a big Pearl Jam fan.
Instead of a telethon, how about an ask-a-thon?
Good. Oh. Chip, you really are funny. We love you.
Thanks. I know.
All right, I'm going.
Where are you going? Colin. You going to write your manifesto with your goddamn cardigan?
I'm good.
Chapter one, same as the other chapters. Maybe if I indent in double space, it'll look more.
I like it better when you do Francesco Quinn.
Francesco Quinn?
Can you do Francesco Quinn before I leave?
I don't know who that is.
From Platoon. When he told, he said, you know, the only one that can kill Bonds is Bonds.
Oh, I thought you meant like Mike Francesa.
Oh.
No.
All right, Quinn.
Dig this, assholes, and dig it good. Barnes been shot 6 times, and Barnes ain't dead. Barnes ain't meant to die. Taylor, I remember when you came in here, you said you admired the man. Yeah, well, I was wrong, man. Wrong. You ain't never been right. I bought nothing. You dig this. Not thinking of Barnes, but Barnes.
Y'all talking about death? Y'all talking about killing? Y'all experts? Well, I'd like to hear about it, potheads. Y'all smoke this shit so as to escape from reality? I don't need this shit. I am reality.
This is how Anthony feels about our country, because when the machine breaks down, we break down, gentlemen, and I can't have that, not from one of you.
Hey, we're going to take a break, because Louis C.K.'s walking down the fucking hall.
I'm just a man who's here in my fucking shoes, sitting in a goddamn chair.
Right on, man.
Colin.
Colin, thank you, sir.
Bye, guys.
Jesus, hello. Colin Quinn.
Hi, we're talking to Colin Quinn on the telephone.
Right. It's fucking Colin.
Yeah. Oh, he's gone. Colin's
gone.
Are you guys still on the air?
Yes. But we're going to take a quick break, right?
I've ever seen in my life.
Are we?
Thank you, man.
I was fucking, we all wept.
That's really nice
goddamn
of you.
Victory weeping when Louis was on SNL.
Oh, man.
Australian sketch.
That is
monologue that kills. I got questions for you, because I know the inner workings.
Oh, that's right. Jay Moore he's an alumni of
Why don't we take a quick break, let Louis take his coat off, and we'll get into it.
Yes.
Fucking Louis C.K.'s here today. I'm so fucking happy.
Nice.
And Jay Moore. Just a man who's here sitting in a fucking chair.
Come by to say hi.
I'm sorry about Obama, Anthony.
I'm sorry.
We're going to get into it.
That's really my first thought was, Anthony.
I know.
So upset.
Thank you. Look at Combs up there, happy as hell. They let me on TV.
Finally. Listen,
Jay. TV.
I'll talk over Jay. Jay Moore at Governor's this weekend, Friday through Sunday. We're going to continue with Louis C.K. next.
Hold the gun straight and turn the phone sideways when you take video.
Sirius XM. And now, the Opie and Anthony Show.
Very cool. We got Jay Moore in studio playing Governor's this Friday through Sunday out there on Long Island. They got their power back. And now we say hi to Louis C.K.
Hey, Louis.
Louis Lincoln.
Louis is here. Hey, guys. Hello, gentlemen.
Jimmy told us earlier today you might stop by, and we're very, very happy you're here.
Gentlemen.
Obviously. We want to talk about SNL, man. Holy fuck.
Yes, I hosted it.
how were the ratings? Do you know what the ratings were when you
They're
did it?
Good. They did
I bet
good.
They were good.
Oh, yeah, they got like whatever. I wasn't like a record-breaking or something, but I think it was the better of the season.
Must nice. Be, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was cool. After the hurricane, and it was the election last before the
You know,
election,
people
so
wanted to laugh. Be. They needed to laugh.
When you need to have a smile on your face, a smile will do.
Yes.
You know,
I'm still
like,
without power, by
it's
the
like
way.
It's like my bumper sticker
Are you
says.
Really?
Yeah.
You're a millionaire. Okay. You don't have a generator of everybody in the world?
He's got a generator.
A generator, but I don't have the one installed yet. I have one going in, but they got to sink a 1,000-gallon fucking LP tank, and then a giant boxcar train-sized generator comes in. So, but and it takes like 6 months.
Maybe
and
you should be nicer to people of color. That would have been done already.
You think so?
Yeah, they would have just come right in and said, let's take care of this guy. He's one of us.
And with all that happening, you know, I don't have... But I got
a guy
got
with him as many guns as you have has to have a generator.
I know. I got to have a generator and fucking metal shutters that just close over the windows and, floodlights, security cameras, scunner, a moat.
You need someone just walking the perimeter.
Perimeter walker guy.
Riot that's all you cannons, need. You know, those riot...
Yeah,
those
yeah.
Things like...
Boom.
And a apartheid truck goes up down the block. How about South Africa actually had vehicles just for breaking up crowds of blacks?
Yeah. Wow.
Like the
really?
Only country in the world. Like just apartheid trucks.
Yeah.
Like, no, this is good because it shoots tear gas and they can't get in. Yeah. It's you can drive right through the crowd. It's nice.
That's right.
Hey!
Now I'm sure they haul money to the corrupt government that's in charge now. Sure.
Well, let's talk about
Jesus South Christ, Africa? Anthony.
Oh my God, it must take so much energy.
Hate is exhausting, Louis. Hate is exhausting.
Well,
tired all the time.
Are you as bummed as somebody's Anthony is about it. Obama being reelected?
No, I'm very happy. I'm very glad.
I'm certain
you know,
of it.
I don't think Romney was... I wouldn't have been horrified if he won. He's a good guy. He's a nice man. He's a decent man. He's a kind man.
Yeah. Sound like Jody Foster describing the rancher.
No, he's a good man, sir.
Yeah.
But
Louis, I didn't know you could do that many impressions and accents when you're. I'm being serious. When you're doing SNL and doing like the Australian,
you know what? The Australian one, I was supposed to be Bill Hader's part, the bigger part, and then we did it in read through, and Lauren said, "Let's let you do the smaller one." Really? Just said it in front of everybody.
Wow. That's a post midnight.
Couldn't let Bill play the big guy. You play the other small one line, and I was like, "Yeah, totally."
Why, were you not nailing the accent?
I wasn't nailing the accent.
That's funny, is it, too, though? If you're not nailing the accent, it's kind of funny.
I was good for one line, and then it started falling apart. Sounding like Irish or Mexican or something.
Lauren protected you.
Yes, he did. No, that's why I was
You would have been out on the wire, and people would have been going, what is this on the internet?
Exactly.
Good for Lauren.
That's right.
What's your thoughts on Lauren Michaels?
I love that guy. I really do. After a week of doing that show, I don't think you can not love the guy because he takes really good care of you. And you get to kind of be... I mean, he's this legendary guy. All I know is my exposure to him is this 1 week. So if you're the host of the show, he like takes care of you. He shepherds you through it. And he also... You get to have all these dramatic Lorne moments. Like there's things that are host-only moments.
Really?
That are so fun because like the last sketch of the show, there was supposed to be two more. And we only had room for, I was told by somebody, you're going to have to choose one sketch.
Oh, wow.
He'll leave it up to you because there's only one left. So then they take me into, somebody comes and gets me and says, come to the control room. This is while we're on the air, you know?
Holy shit.
And they go over there and Lauren's waiting for me in the dark of the control room with his arms folded. And I go over.
Petting a cat.
Yes. That's what it was like. And he goes, he just says simply, you can have one. It's your choice.
Like and Mary I already was holding it. A boy and a girl.
I already knew what he about it, but because he was making such a I pretended I was like, oh,
really thinking it out.
Wow. Yeah, I knew I wanted to do that one.
You should have said, yeah, I know.
And then, somebody already told me. Yeah. You don't even run this place anymore.
You should have pointed to somebody in the control room and said, I'll have him.
I'll take that one.
I'll take that one.
What was the other option?
Sketch where I played John Tesh.
Why'd you have to go on?
I don't know. It was a tough choice because the John Tesh was really funny. It was a crazy bit. I ended up taking a chainsaw to a whole set and like, destroying a set with a chainsaw.
Well, they should film that anyway. Throw it on the internet.
They probably did a dress, right?
They did it a dress and it did well. So maybe they might throw it up there
somewhere. That'd be nice.
You probably chose and they were like, oh.
Well,
wow.
I felt bad too because the kid in it, this guy Tim, he was playing Dave Tesh, my brother. I don't think they were really Dave Tesh. And he was really funny and he's new. So he would have gotten a big boost. But so was Kate, who was in the bar sketch. I just knew that if I licked her face on the TV, it would get big laugh. Fuck yeah.
That was great, dude. That was a fucking rolling, massive laugh, which you don't see on
really
on
fun
live TV that much.
Yeah. Absolutely. That's a great, like, that was the, you know, a lot of stuff goes by quickly. But that was a moment I was able to, like, stop for. Was
oh, really? Yeah.
When I'm licking her face and people are going nuts and out, and you're aware this is on live fucking television.
Are you aware of that and constantly, by the way?
Not only a few moments, but that was one of them. Like, this is on TV right now that I'm doing this, and I can lick her face as long as I want. And they'd have to, like, come and get me. And at one point, I got my nose in her mouth, and I decided my goal in my head is I'm going to try to get my whole head in her mouth. And I started pushing up into her mouth with my nose, and I felt her go, because she was gagging on my nose.
Dude, if she would have vomited on you, that would have been the greatest moment in live TV history.
Amazing. But I started laughing right then, so I stopped.
It was getting huge laughs up to that, though. I mean, the fucking every line was getting a laugh.
It was,
the open mouth kiss, which was a little obnoxious, got a huge laugh, and then right into the tug. Right,
yeah. Jimmy, you didn't see the monologue, right?
We came into the dressing room. I watched it with so
that was the first thing Jay said when Lou walked in. Just an amazing
one of the best ever.
One of the best ever. Wow.
From being on the inside, what people don't realize is for some reason it's what they work on last. Like you get like Sally Field and all day you practice sketches, and then like on Saturday they're still trying to bang out a monologue like at 4 in the afternoon. And for some
and how good is, you know,
that's
you
why get... the monologue is always terrible. It's always terrible.
Well, it's
like,
really
hey,
important.
Waka waka.
You realize when you do it how important it is, because you get when they I never thought of this. I always thought of each sketch as its own compartmentalized thing. But when you host the show, they need to hook into you as a person.
Because
when you're in the sketches, whether you're playing whatever mountain man or whatever it is, they have to like you to get into the sketch. I didn't think of that. Mm.
Yeah, so that opening's pretty important. Yeah, to kind of
I mean, in the dress rehearsal, the monologue I did like twice the amount to so they could look at it all and decide what to do.
Mm.
And it went well. But then the first sketch I did after the monologue was a sketch that didn't air. Where I play a drawing teacher with kids, and I'm really mean. And they hated me for it.
Really?
So, wow. Yeah, it kind of fucked me for the rest of the show.
Really?
I don't think you want to say rape in your monologue.
I don't want to rape a child.
No, that might work below 14th Street, but up here.
Exactly. I call a little girl a whore in that sketch.
That's hilarious. Yeah, come on.
Yeah, no, right. You would have liked it. It was funny.
Yeah.
Maybe after the news.
It's like it's like a thing where I'm saying you can draw anything with your imagination. And like I draw three circles and I go, this could be anything you want. Maybe it's a robot ant. And some kid goes, maybe it's balloons. And I go, it's a robot ant. I think I was pretty clear it's a robot ant. And then later I decided, and I start kicking the kids out one by one. And then at the end, I go, maybe it's balloons. This could be a pink balloon. And this girl goes, it could be red. And I go, it's pink, you little whore.
Oh, wow. Shit. That's great.
Awesome. And then I get arrested by the cops. But then the next sketch, everyone was like, boo.
Wow.
Because I'm so mean.
I'm surprised it got cut and not moved just after the second song.
Well, I had a chance to defend it. Like, Lauren took the card off the board and kind of held it. Like, he said, this is vulnerable.
And wow.
And I said, you know what? Just get rid of it.
We're leaving our flank open with this.
Yeah.
Wow.
So you were in the room when they pick the sketches, no one else ever is. It's you, and who's the head writer now?
Seth Meyer, and there was a decent amount of people in there. It was, what's his name?
Kenny Amon?
Steve Higgins.
Higgins.
And a few other people whose names I didn't know.
Were there sketches that got picked that you went, whoa, I'm not sure why?
No, I mean, the read-through was really strong.
Yeah.
There was a lot of good material, so I liked everything they picked. There was only two bits that I hated, that I just don't like personally, and they didn't... The thing you learn after a long time is you don't have to fight stuff right when you see it.
Yeah.
Sometimes things get taken care of on their own, and if you fought them, and then you know what I mean? So there was two sketches I never liked.
They were on the board.
And I didn't say a word about them.
You mean they were on the board?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then after dress, they got cut. And
were you happy?
It didn't matter.
That.
Very happy.
Of course.
I only torpedoed one sketch. And I felt bad because the writer was a nice guy. And he was sitting right there. And I was saying, this is not that funny. It's not satisfying. Like, I fought against one.
What was it?
It wasn't on. So.
But you had to actually come out and say, like, I guess...
The only one that I said something about, because I just didn't... I didn't think I was doing a good job of it, too, so... Mm.
What was the gist of the one you torpedoed?
The guy's a nice guy. Fuck his life up.
Right.
Yeah. I want to ask Lou what he was thinking right before they intro'd you.
Yeah, your heart must have been racing.
Yeah, what goes through your fucking mind?
Well, it's really emotional, because it's a whole week, and everything I've ever done that's new, I always go through.
What did I draw?
Immature.
Let me knock this water over.
He's Jimmy open. Has to go, ha-ha.
As you do. As Lou is trying to open up his fucking heart for everybody.
Sorry.
Jesus. No, thank God.
I don't, don't worry about what fell. Who gives a fuck? It's just a remote.
It's hilarious.
So you're a bunch of jerks.
So you're waiting to
really
go on.
Emotional click.
So you're waiting to go on camera for the first time.
Okay, so you do all this shit and you doubt yourself like 8-10 times during the week. Like this, I'm going to suck at this. There's a lot of process and it's exhausting. And then you finally get to, then it's finally you're standing behind this door and the music's playing and there's Don Pardo's voice saying, Jesus. You know. And there's this woman named Jenna who's the stage director and she's getting ready to, you know, she's really serious and counting down.
Oh, shit.
That's the worst.
And I said, Jenna, like I was urgent. I said, Jenna. And she goes, what? And I scared the shit out of her because we're 2 seconds
right
to me going out.
You can't do anything.
And I'm talking to her like there's a problem. And she goes, what? And I said, I'm hosting Saturday Night Live.
Nice.
And she goes, yes, you are. And then she pushes the door
open. Asshole.
That's awesome.
But that's how I felt. Like, I mean, because I'm 45 now, so... anything that you let go, that you will let go pass without enjoying it, you're a real turd.
Right.
You feel like an asshole.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
So I just, she's standing there. I wanted to tell somebody, I'm fucking doing this right now.
That's so fucking
so
cool.
I came out, I was really emotional and I was really happy.
Right.
When I came out.
That's awesome.
You change, like, being 45, you're saying, like, you want to enjoy everything as you're doing it, because it's, like, sometimes with an experience, it's, like, so fucking tense and nerve-wracking, you don't even enjoy it. You just,
right.
you're like, okay, I'll look back on this, and it will be fun, instead of fucking liking
enjoying the moment.
You have to stop and go, I may never do this again. It's amazing I'm getting to do this.
Yeah. Did you feel totally prepared after a week? Did you feel like, okay, I'm good? I don't feel
not
like
completely. And yeah. I was so excited. It's not a helpful emotion to be happy.
Yeah.
Because I sputtered the first few lines of the monologue. I was too excited. And fucked me up. Because, like, the first joke I said was, the power's back on, so we can go back to using way too much electricity. And I've done this before. I was so excited that I'm trying to say everything too soon. So I said, the power's back on, which means we can use way too much electricity. Because the word way was the first laugh.
Right.
So I said way like 6 times before it was time to
the
say
way
it.
Back on
because I was too happy.
Yes.
Way.
Yes. You said curds.
Yeah. Curds way. And it got nothing. I rushed past it because it didn't get a laugh to the next thing.
Wow.
But I'm on fucking live TV, so you're thinking you fucked up the first joke. And now you're subsequently fucking up the second one.
Ooh.
And this could be a black hole that sucks the entire monologue in it. Unless you know when they burn forest to stop a forest fire?
Yeah.
You got to get a firewall in here somewhere.
Right.
I was having that thought somewhere in the
monologue.
I know
where your firewall was.
Where was it? Because
when old lady falls down and you see her inappropriate parts.
Yes, that was
the
firewall.
That was the exact moment where everybody went, fuck. Okay. Everyone got off the hook.
Yes.
That was it, right?
That was the first laugh that made me feel normal.
Yeah.
And then I was
settled,
I'm
right
gonna
in.
Be okay.
You settled right in.
So goddamn funny, that story.
Yeah.
Do they talk to you about not breaking the fourth wall? Because I'm always amazed no one on SNL ever breaks that wall.
You mean during the sketches?
Yeah. Do they say to you, don't do it? Or do you? Or is it just?
Why would he look at the fucking camera in the middle of a sketch?
No. No, but I mean, nobody even does it. Ironically, if something bombs, like nobody does it.
He broke.
With the mountain sketch.
Yeah.
Because I fucked up so
a
many things.
Times he broke the wall.
I made so many mistakes because there was all these marks I was supposed to hit.
Oh.
And every time we rehearsed it, I didn't go to any of them. And then they would say really nicely, we have no shots if you don't move.
The whole shot, it was like a big master.
It's a big master. They needed me to move down.
It was a one shot. The whole sketch, now that I think about it,
yeah, because if I had moved, they would have had a better shot. So
no one had any coverage.
They wrote it on the cards in huge letters. They wrote step down.
Oh, wow.
And they said, we're going to do this for you so you don't have to worry about it. And I was like, thank you. Yeah, no, that's cool. I'll see that. And then after like three lines, I realized I haven't moved.
Oh,
yeah, totally fucked.
But your cool beard looked great.
And then I had this crazy
hair.
He looks good with long hair.
He looked awesome.
That's what
man.
We said.
There's nothing. We're
like, damn, Louis looks good with long
hair. There was
hair.
No weak thing. There was no like. There's always like a hunk of shit, like 10 feet, where you're like, ugh. Where you're like, God, and you're like, now after that shit sketch, I got to go to commercial. Then there's a fucking band I don't know. After that bullshit, there was no bullshit. It was one of the better episodes I've ever seen.
Oh, and, thanks, man.
And after the one sketch, you laughed. So he did break down the fourth wall.
The hotel sketch
at the end, there was a huge laugh, and I kind of liked that.
I want to make a point real quick.
Hold on. What was that about?
The kid, Bobby Moynihan, who was, that's his name, right?
Yeah.
I think, who's in the sketch with me. He's a really nice guy, and I don't know. I just liked him, and we were doing it all week, you know?
Right.
That whole thing was dependent on me keeping that rhythm going. It was another one where I just kept... just misplacing little words and fucking up. And I felt like I made so many mistakes. But I don't know. And I was having a good time by then. I was really enjoying the show by then.
Yeah, the laugh was great.
And I knew we were close to the end, and I was feeling all this cool relief and stuff, you know?
So you kind of just let it out.
Yeah, $7 or $150,000.
Yeah. And also, they had told me this thing right before we went on. There's going to be a sound of a printer. And you're going to hear it jam, and then that's when you say it jammed, and I couldn't hear anything.
Oh, shit.
It was on the air, but I couldn't. I was just standing there waiting, and there was, like, this long pause on fucking live television. And so I just picked a moment to say the printer jammed, and then we went away with really no laugh at the end. So I'm just pounding on this fake keyboard, and I looked at Bobby, and we both just started crying.
I liked it. It was a real moment.
Let me just say this real quick. Whenever a comic that we kind of know of hosts SNL, all of us in this room, and you have to fucking admit it, a party roots against the fucking guy.
Oh, holy shit.
Louis is the only guy in my lifetime that walked through those doors, and I was with him. Like a guy, Opie said it when I was here the other day, like watching Louis, it was like one of my guys, like I'm a fucking coach, but like one of our guys,
from
the stoop.
It was awesome.
It was like the moment, and fucking Don Pardo, ladies and gentlemen. You know, Paulie Shore. You know, the party is going to be like, I hope this fucking tanks. But with Louie, you're like, holy shit.
Yeah, we were standing in the phone booth by a car going, they're going to make this fucking.
Yeah, they're going to make it.
But yeah, it's gonna be bullets. And then you walk through the curtains, and there's just a bunch of chairs stacked up.
Oh no!
CK come out of this empty.
He must be like actually 90, right?
And there's nothing anybody could do about it.
That's that.
Yeah, and that's that.
He spun it on a line. He's a redheaded cunt, and there's nothing can be done.
It was payback for Joe Dixo leaving his stage manager. Real greaseball shit.
We were so happy for you, Lo.
Yeah.
In my house, we were so fucking happy. I want to ask you about the week, because it's legendary how many hours you put in and people sleep there. Like, what was your experience?
Well, I knew it's all about energy management, you know? Mm-hmm. And my show is really hard, but the show I do on FX is hard work, so I'm used to that.
What show is that?
What show is that?
Fuck.
Sorry.
Oh, yeah. We got to talk about the Emmys. We got so much. I want to talk about Emmys and a book that went
bad. You won Emmys, you animal.
I won a couple, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway, the week on SNL, then we'll move on to the Emmys.
So you learn some stuff after a while. When you're young, you can just keep regenerating. You don't lose power. It just keeps coming, you know? You can really fuck yourself up. Like kids that are on the football team in high school and they smoke cigarettes and stuff and they get fucked up and the next day they're gods. And at 45, I literally knew I was capable of throwing the thing away if I wasn't careful. So there are little simple things. Like I didn't put any sugar in my bloodstream for the week. Like I didn't eat any.
Really?
Yeah, no sugar. Just like a lot of fruit, a lot of water. Kept my and anytime I loved being there, and there's a lot of really great guys in the show, Bill Hader and Fred Armisen, that are old friends of mine, and so I'd find myself in the hallway talking to a couple of guys and making jokes and laughing, and then I'd tell myself, stop it, go back to your room and sit down. Just stop doing that, because that's a useless, expensive energy.
Jeez, you really
work really hard all week, and none of it's on television. You're pushing and working and working and working, and none of it has, you still haven't done a single fucking thing. Until 11:30 on Saturday, you have accomplished nothing. Wow. So it's...
Wow.
Yeah, so yeah. I've drank a lot of hot tea and shit to keep my throat nice.
It would be great if you snapped during the monologue and just said all of this. Like, if you're...
Next time, Jimmy. Yeah.
Like, what? If you just start saying that.
The audience is just looking at him.
Like, what happened?
Is he okay? Ladies and gentlemen, Rich Voss.
Look at the black chicks checking me out.
By the way, a lot of people have talked about the moment you hear Don Pardo say your name. Nobody hears Don Pardo say. You can't hear it.
No, huh?
No, oh, you really? Got the band right in your face.
Oh, that's true.
You just see your...
Just cue
someone
you
just
to
starts
go out,
screaming,
yeah.
Go, go, go!
So she was
so everybody's
super
lying when they say
intense,
that they,
lady Jenna, because when Joe,
yeah, she's great though, she's a very mama kind of person.
When Joe Dixo did it from like 77 on, mm-hmm. he was like really old, he would go like 30 seconds away, and then every Saturday he'd go 5 seconds. It's like this little old man, he thought he's having a heart, and everybody would laugh and it was all relaxed. So it's interesting now there's like a taskmaster doing it.
She's good.
And how many hours a day are you putting in at the offices?
Long, and well, the Tuesday is the first big day. I was there till 3 a.m.
Ooh.
And then the next day, it depends on what you're shooting and stuff. Like the Lincoln thing that we did was pretty easy.
That was awesome.
Those guys did all of that. I mean, I didn't write any of that. I came up with stand up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But Seth Meyers wrote it. It was his idea, the whole thing. And he even gave me the premises for the stand up. Like he threw ideas up to me and.
Wow,
they really did it, cool. And they've got their film crew like researched what cameras we used and on the show, and they matched everything exactly. And
Daryl said they wear the same clothes too. Like when they do a sketch about a politician, they wear the exact same suits. Like they're really,
The woman, 80, who played who played Mary Todd Lincoln, she was wearing a dress that is at the Met Museum. That's like they were really uptight about the dress.
She was funny.
She was funny. But her dress is like a national treasure.
The research Holy department shit. On SNL
yeah, it's crazy that, what
is
they...
so ridiculous. Like, you go, there's just a group, when Louis obviously is a way better story, but real quickly, there's like two desks of research people, and you go, hey, I need footage inside Apollo 18.
Yeah.
And they literally, like, in 2 hours, there's like 9 VHS tapes and still footage. And you're like, how did you find this?
There was no Apollo 18.
That's why I just pulled that out of my ass.
Yeah, how are they going to get footage of that? I don't think so.
Easy, Chip.
Hey, congratulations on the Emmys, too, man.
Thanks,
man. You won how many? You won two?
You said Emmys, too. TWO.
No, I meant comma TOO.
I know what you meant.
Did you decide to take a year off before that or after it?
Before the Emmys.
Oh, you said I'm just tired?
Didn't until after.
Okay.
Well, I wanted more time to do the show because I do it. I turn in episodes I know are not as good as they could be because they're just too fast. Mm. So I'm not taking that much time off. I'm taking like 2 months off, and then I'm starting to work. I usually start working on the show in December, and I'm going to start working on it in September. So I'm getting a huge amount more time
to
do the same amount of work.
Oh, okay.
So it'll just be better.
Right.
That's all.
Wow.
I also wanted to stop for a bit.
I got to also ask, look at the boat. What happened with your boat?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That was all of a sudden like, fucking... wow, Louis's like a tabloid guy.
Yeah, Louis C.K. in his boat.
Yeah. Just hanging out waiting to be rescued.
I got stuck in the mud.
new Black Crowes album.
It was my first day. Yes. It was my first day in the
stuck in
boat.
The mud.
Oh.
I just bought it. And I spent one day on it with some guy who showed me the specifics of the boat. But it's this big fucking boat with two engines, right. And it's really complicated to drive. And I took my girls out on it. And as we were pulling out of the marina, my daughter was like, how do you know how to do this?
Oh, shit.
And I was like, it's not that big a deal. Like, I was defensive with my 10-year-old. It's not that big a deal. I could do this. And we went around Manhattan, and I got in all this shit I had no qualifications
That's
to deal with.
That's a crazy waterway, because the current...
Especially on these sides.
Especially, what do they call that fucking...
It's an estuary.
Don't they call it Devil's something?
It's like something...
Hell's Gate.
Hell's Gate.
That's
right.
All the water converges right there.
They should call it Watergate.
Where the rivers kind of split.
The Long Island Sound collides with the Harlem River.
Right, right. That's it. Yeah. It gets a little dicey over
it's
there.
Really
Don't
bad.
Say the Harlem River around Anthony today.
No.
I'm all right.
A little sensitive.
It's been a renaissance up there.
Don't say Muddy River.
moment when we were in that cauldron and we just smashed, like the boat felt like it was coming apart. And boom! my 7-year old screamed, and her sister held her eyes like closing them. It was like,
what the fuck are you doing? It was really stressful.
Were you panicking?
Then we get, I mean, it's nervy, but
it was making that smack sound of the water. The bow goes like, bam!
It was really bad.
It's where the Harlem River meets
the
Long Island Sound.
The Long Island Sound, the East River,
the Harlem
River.
You've never seen before.
Yeah.
It's crazy to go through that area.
You get whirlpools.
Like up by Yankee Stadium?
You get all kinds of like lumber.
No, on the east side.
It's fucking
lumber floating around. Not far from Yankee Stadium. Not far from there.
Oh, yeah. Well, it is. Yeah, Yankee Stadium's on the east side. It's south of there.
It's crazy to navigate that.
It's just north of Roosevelt Island.
Yeah,
correct.
And are you thinking, I just want somebody who knows how to do this here right now with me?
Yeah. And then we went up to the Harlem River, which is very... It's awesome. Like glass.
It's really nice.
And so now everybody, we got through it and we're really happy. And I've got frozen burritos and macaroni and cheese. So we're going to pull over, throw the anchor, and we're going to make lunch. And so I find this little cove, this sweet little cove.
It's nice.
And
in Harlem?
There's people in a park next to it. And it's just a nice place. So I pull in there and the boat just stops moving all of a sudden. And, everything starts beeping because
the boat
is
gauge
the boat is cooled by water in that it's sitting in, so now it's just sucking mud up into the this 2-hour old engines are now packed with mud. And I just shut everything off because I know everything's overheating.
Oh man!
And my daughters go, "What's going on?" And I said, I turned to them and I said, "You need not to ask me any questions for a little while."
Oh shit!
Yeah.
And the park ranger calls over to me from the shore and he says, "You ain't going anywhere. It's low tide. You're going to be stuck there for a long time." And I'm like, "No. It's all right. It's all right." I'm trying not to let my daughters hear this. And I call the Coast Guard, whatever, the Channel 16. I'm like, anybody can tow me out of here. And these cops show up on the boat. And they're like 50 yards away, and they're not going to come anywhere near me.
No.
And they said, you're going to have to wait till high tide. Yeah, it's around 1 o'clock, and, and I'm on the radio with the cops, and they go, "You're going to have to wait till high tide." And I said, "When's that?" And they said, "Maybe midnight tonight."
Oh, no.
Both my daughters start crying.
Did you stay the whole time or did you get out?
There was no way to get out because in a few minutes, we were surrounded by mud. And it was like quicksand. Like I put a stick in it and it just fell into the mud.
Fuck. Were you embarrassed?
Fucking very.
That's one of the best questions I've ever heard. Quick, salient, succinct.
Oh, man.
I was really embarrassed.
So you were pretty much just like no more water. Your boat is sitting in muck.
Mud. Yeah.
In mud.
Really
gross. And you're waiting for the tide to come back in. Were you afraid that it was just going to be stuck in the mud and
I was afraid
not
of that.
Come up?
I was afraid. My daughter was like, what if we like keel over? What if we start tipping over? I'm like, that can't happen. And in my head, I'm like, that could totally happen. And the cops said they would go get us food because we couldn't cook any of the food now because it needs a generator to
throw
run
it
the fucking oven.
How would they get it to you?
Well, that was a big deal because they went and got us food. The cops, they bought us a whole chicken and some rice. Really nice guys. Then they come back and now there's a huge expanse of mud between us
and
them.
The food.
And they go, "We don't know how you're going to get this." They put it in a garbage bag. And I start throwing a line to them, but it's not making it. All these people on the shore, everybody knows who I am now.
Oh, no. Oh.
So there's people in the park and the shore who are just on a rail just watching me. And I'm throwing this, I've tied a pot to the rope, and I throw it. And
hilarious.
It gets about halfway there, and I'm pulling it back, and I'm covered in mud.
Because
every time the rope comes back, it's totally covered in mud, and I have to get the mud off so it's not heavy. Every time I go to throw it, all the people on the side, half of them are going, "We're pulling for you, Louie. You can do it." And then when I miss, they go, "Oh, man. Dude sucks."
It's like playing left field for the Yankees.
Yeah, it's totally the Yankee Stadium crowd. People booed.
Wow.
And I couldn't get it. So finally, the cops pulled over a guy who was fishing. And they used his rod to throw me a line.
Cast a line.
They cast a weight over
me. Oh, nice.
So you're able
to tied
that.
It to a rope.
Right.
Oh, shit. They pulled. And then I had to pull dinner onto the boat. I was so soaked in mud and sweat. Totally.
Then it was chicken mole after that.
That's right. Had your kids calm down by that point?
They were great. My kids were amazing.
Yeah. Then what happens at midnight?
We waited and waited. Once in a while, like, it started raining a little bit, and I heard some from the darkness in the park, some kid go, "Hey, Louis, CK, it's raining out now." This is crazy.
Fucking asshole.
But the kid, those guys at the marina where I keep the boat, they're really cool guys, and they sent some kid, some young guy, and in a boat, and they just dropped him in the water, and he swam to us.
Jesus.
Crazy kid. And he came on board with me and helped me get it out. Once the water came up, we used the bow thruster to shove the boat
around. Oh, you got a little bow thruster on there.
Were you feeling it rise as the water's coming? You're like, oh, God.
No, the boat wasn't moving because the water was coming up and the boat was just sitting there. Stuck in the mud. So that's why we used the bow thrusters or above
shake
the mud.
Shake it loose. Wow.
So we shook the boat around.
Whoa.
And it worked.
And at one point, the tide was starting to go down again. And the guy that was with me said, "It's your call, but we could put it in. We could turn the engines on and put it in reverse and try to get out of here."
World.
What'd you do?
Yeah, it was like Apollo 13 because everything had been off for a long time. Yeah, and now we're like, he says, "We have 10 seconds of battery." It was all this stuff.
Oh, yes. Shit.
So we fired up and just put it in reverse and mud just blah. It was crazy.
We don't have enough limbs to get Louis out of the mud.
Any damage to the boat?
It's pride.
Propeller was, my propeller was bent a little.
2 hours.
But now the hurricane threw my boat into a street somewhere.
Are you serious? Yeah.
The hurricane fucking towed your boat.
I don't know. They said that nobody. I was at the marina where they had it. They said all boats came off their blocks because the surge came up under the boats.
Fucking Captain Louie.
And they said all boats were damaged.
I think God is telling you not to have a boat, though. Yeah, exactly.
Nice.
You got to find another hobby. What are you going to do next? Go around Somalia?
Jesus. Now, Louie, didn't you have a depth gauge indicator where that would go like when you get shallow water?
Yeah. The mud happens so suddenly. You have to know the waters. You need to look at your charts.
Right.
You can't just look at the depth finder.
And the tributaries. You have to know them as well.
The depth finder tells you what the depth is directly under
your boat, right?
Yeah. So you can tell you what's coming.
You'll just go up on it and then it'll...
If he knew it was coming, he wouldn't be near Harlem.
You're just going out there trying to catch Walter, and you know, you and Billy hit the rock on Golden Pond.
Oh, God.
Fucking Catherine Hepburn comes out with her fucking head boogieing.
Oh my God! Wow, that is fucked up, Louie.
It was a funny. Jesus. Well, my girls went through this whole thing with me as we came into the we went down the Hudson River to go home at midnight. And I said to my daughter, "We have to come back out on the boat so you can have a positive experience." And
she
said, "We just did have a positive experience."
Oh, that's nice.
Plus, they got
to stay up late.
Yeah. Well, they don't like staying up late. They're 10 and 7.
Yeah.
They just want to go to sleep.
Is there a downstairs on the boat?
I got a 10-year-old. He's like, stares at the TV all night.
Does he?
Yeah, he's a boy.
Yeah,
I can't stop doing Colin.
Yeah. Mm.
Stares at the TV all night.
Mm. Well, why don't we take a break? Louis C.K.'s here. Jay
watching
Moore.
Watching C-SPAN like a weirdo.
Jay Moore is at Governor starting Friday. All right?
All right.
And I'm in Texas.
Friday through Sunday.
And Jimmy's at the Addison Improv in Texas.
I'm at Governor Connolly's.
In 2 weeks.
In 2 weeks. 15 feet.
He gave me the cue. I didn't know you were done.
Well, can you see my lips moving?
Yeah, just go.
Who's that old guy over there? Uncle Paul. Uncle Paul. With the creepy old guy stare. Uncle Paul. Now he's coming over here. Slowly limping down the hall. It's too late now, cause here comes Uncle Paul.
Let me show you how to make a big boy love you.
In today's episode, Uncle Paul tells us about teaching karate.
My friend was a karate teacher. You'd get in there and everybody would take off our clothes. Yeah, let me show you the crane. Give Sensei Paul a kiss. Shh. Get over here and drink Uncle Paul's snake oil. Judo, judo, chop, chop, chop. Chop your penis.
Who's that old guy over there? Uncle Paul, Uncle Paul. With the creepy old guy stare. Uncle Paul. Now he's coming over here. Slowly limping down the hall. It's too late now, cause here comes Uncle Paul.
This is the Opie and Anthony Show.
You guys eat. Everybody's eating.
Anthony's show. We're blowing up.
I yelled at E-Rock. I'm like, come back. What are you doing? It's fucking 9:35 already. He's like, well, they want material.
9:35.
We go as long as we want.
Yeah. Go as long as you want, honey.
I got to go back home and power my house back up. Every morning when I leave, I power it down. I turn off the generator. And then when I go home, yeah, and that's exactly what it's like.
5 seconds to total shutdown.
I was telling him I went through a generator the other day, Saturday. My generator just fucking died.
For sure.
And it's like you're sitting inside. And you get used to the sound of the generator, and then it just goes, oh. It's quiet, and the lights go out, and you're all fucking back in the just it, like a caveman again. Mm-hmm.
But I think Louis had the best point about you, Anthony. Of all people, how are you not like Mr. Generator when the storm's rolling?
He's hooking that up. He's gonna have a thousand gallon fuel tank.
It's like you're a doomsday scenario guy, right?
Thousand gallon fuel tank. By the way, that's good for how like with 3 days. That's the crazy thing.
Yeah, exactly.
I think no one wanted to, so they were just refused to take the moment of the hurricane to realize how much fuel we use.
Yeah. Like, it's amazing.
People downtown, really cool, green people downtown, didn't just refuse to notice. It's like
yes.
People are sitting with generators in the middle of the Greenwich Village. There's a generator. It's fucking. It's just pissing through gas to charge up 3 iPhones. You plug your iPhone into the wall and so that you can do really cool apps about how green you are and how liberal you are burning fucking tons of gallons of Arab fuel.
Of fuel.
It's so fucking, it's just hypocritical.
Arabs.
And you also realize when there's no fuel at gas stations and then there's one opens up, the long lines that are out there, you're start realizing how much fuel people go through when all the gas stations are open.
That's right.
It's a huge amount.
It's crazy.
It's insane. I am in a position now where today I'm dipping below a quarter tank of gas in my truck. I only have one more jug of gas for the generator.
Mm-hmm.
And my whole existence for the past 8 fucking days has been, where do I get fuel today? Yep. It's like the Road Warrior. You're just constantly trying to find fuel.
Was this storm, this was worse than Katrina, right?
Well,
no, the storm, not the repercussions, the storm itself.
The storm itself.
No, Katrina
was a Frankenstorm.
Category 5.
Katrina was a category 3 when it hit land.
Yeah, this was one, but it was
unheard of for
land. It's where it hit. And they were underwater, like they're below sea level, their whole fucking city.
They started below sea level. So I was curious if Katrina was worse or this one was worse. Katrina was worse.
When you look at
I use my hands to show you guys what I mean by separate storm.
Katrina when you look at the Superdome filled with people shitting themselves.
But that's the repercussions. The actual weather, which one weather-wise?
Well, Staten Island
got fucking trash.
Somebody answer my questions, I'm tipping this fucking table.
I'm telling you, Katrina was worse. It was a 3 or 4. This one was maybe a 1 or a tropical storm. It kept getting downgraded and then back up.
But there were other factors that made this, as they're calling it now, the superstorm.
That's Frankenstorm.
You can't just say that it was a one hurricane.
The location was crazy because between Long Island and Jersey, the water just backed up in there. Yep. There was nowhere for it to go.
Just pushing that water.
And just went everywhere over the barrier islands and everything. Just fucking
this storm was worse. When his boat hit mud.
Could have used
The storm was worse. This one was. Because it happened to me.
Right. Because you were directly involved. Yeah. Really. This
fucking
was
had
worse.
To cancel 2 shows.
You guys got 2 eggs.
Katrina.
You guys got 2 eggs. He's sitting here with an egg in his beard.
And we haven't found Lou's boat yet.
Nah, I haven't found the boat.
You want people to find your boat for you?
What's that?
I know.
Can you tell? I don't know if you will. I'll just
What's
ask,
name
though.
Of your boat?
Yeah, the name of the boat and how much it cost you that it's now just somewhere.
No. I know he'll answer one of those.
I know. I don't think he'll do the.
Yeah, the name of the boat was Dogs. Dogs.
With a G or with an S or a Z?
It was
what?
With an S or a Z.
No, so fuck you. You said G first.
Yeah, I did. But I
how many D A W G Z?
Dogs.
How many? How many foot?
34 feet.
34.
We know about.
I got a pretty good.
That's
idea.
A fucking big nut.
Louis Baller.
Wow,
that's a big nut.
Good.
Yeah,
that's good. Pretty good. Yeah, nice yeah.
So, what did you? Why dogs?
Because somebody called me and said they're shipping it right now, and someone's standing there with a spray can.
You got to come up with a name.
Come up with a name now. And I was busy, and I just said, dogs.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
And that's it.
Works.
And I forgot I did it, and when I went to take the boat out of Lindenhurst, I'm like, oh, what did I say that?
Yeah, I know. A better name would have been, I'm a non-captain cunt. So what do? You pick it up on a trailer hitch, or do they ship it to where
trailer
you want?
Hitch.
I don't know. I don't know how it works.
It was being kept in.
It's a little big for a.
Oh.
It was being kept in Jersey City.
To back and down a fucking slip. Yeah. A fucking.
Yeah, you don't. You don't launch that.
The ramp.
Come on, son.
You take it down to the local boat ramp at Ashroken and dump it out.
Let's catch some sunnies.
Yeah, some sunnies.
The bluegills are all over the place. Who knows where the bass are, right, Kate?
Snappers.
Yeah, with your girlfriend in cutoff shorts pretending to help
right,
while you're launching it.
So you're cranking that.
I don't know what to just all do it.
Yeah. Wow, that's fucking. That's a pretty big size boat for your first boat.
Yeah, I mean I've had smaller boats.
Oh, you have
little motorboats and stuff.
Yeah,
I never had a thing like that.
Two engines, you got to fucking.
No,
work
it's got
those,
a spinning. It's got radar.
Right, oh, nice. That spinny thing is cool as fuck.
Everything but a mud detector.
Everything but a competent user. in the hands of an asshole, a total worthless piece of fiberglass.
But it was in the Post, I think. It was funny. That's
it was. We saw the pictures and we're like, oh no,
it's a better story though. I had a great trip around Manhattan. Who cares? Yeah. I got stuck in the mud. That's
exactly
a great story,
right.
Man.
Beach, I'm really
fans on the fence like that.
Yelling at you.
That's right.
Seems so.
Louis C.K. It's starting to rain now. You should have bought a robot.
Like a little
aunt.
Kid, thanks. Like a little Puerto Rican kid.
Hey, Louis C.K.
He didn't know. Like somebody told him that who that was.
It's starting to rain.
Thanks.
Thanks
should, you should rename the boat to Follies.
That's a good one. Jesus. Now we're supposed to have more shit today, which...
when does that shit start? Soon?
This afternoon. Nah. It's already getting a little gusty out there.
Today, supposed to. 50, 60 mile an hour wind coming back.
I'm kind of glad they didn't turn my fucking power on because it just would have gone out today. My power goes out constantly. But it's going to take something like 6 months to put this generator in because I need all kinds of fucking permits and shit.
It's for next year.
Yeah. And then they got to bury something that's akin to a submarine for the fuel and then truck in this giant generator, tie it into my house. But then when the power goes out, the entire, and I mean everything, I could turn every single electrical device on in my house and this handles it. So
how long does a full tank last, though?
2 minutes, 3 minutes. A
couple weeks, maybe?
It's at full blast, I would assume 1,000 gallons of liquid
less
propane.
Than a week.
Someday an archaeologist is going to go through your neighborhood like thousands of years from now. And they're going to find your house with that tank, that 1,000 gallon tank. And be like, this must have been the king of the whole world. This man must have been the ruler.
But they're going to find a skeleton alone in the house.
He was very proud of his various weapons. He's surrounded by them.
His subjects all left him before the invasion, like leaves falling from a tree.
Oh, by the way, some of Long Island has already lost power.
Oh, already?
Yeah.
Jesus.
That's coming in by a few people.
Just to shove it up my ass for governor's
house. That's where we were born and raised, and every time the wind blows, the fucking power goes.
See, I'm from Jersey, and
every single fucking time.
Why is that? Why wouldn't you guys have a more?
Because they don't cut down the trees and the wires are above ground.
A bunch of Italians can't get together and go, this is what we're going to do about the power.
Yeah.
It's going to be a bad week for Staten Island people.
Yeah, Staten Island.
They got nothing.
Staten Island.
I'm going there to do a couple of shows at the St. George, I think, this Saturday before Thanksgiving. This is a place called the St. George Theater.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
So I'm going to do two shows there. I think we're going to give half the tickets to people locally away
that
they can come. And then the other half for
you can do that
money.
When you're a big shot.
It's the best medicine.
Something you get to do.
I'm handing out my CDs if anybody wants them. Just to make you feel better about your own lives. Here, I actually put this out and thought it was good.
Jimmy goes, I'm handing these out. $10, please.
The money's going to go to the fucking relief. Some drug addict if she takes my cum.
Holy shit.
I'm sorry. I like prostitutes. What do you think? They're college grads? They're fucking druggies. Who else would come to my house during the hurricane?
I did.
He did get one.
He got one
during the hurricane.
Yeah, she charged an extra 50 because she said the cabbies were price gouging her.
Yeah.
I'm like, all right.
But he got one in the middle of the hurricane.
He should have said no. That would have been so mean. No. Well, you pay it.
While people are losing their boats and homes, Jimmy was able to get a fucking...
Yeah, get a hooker.
Young lady to his house.
Great.
Well, hopefully. Allegedly.
Yeah, allegedly. Sure. Any sure. water play? True.
No.
There's enough water play outside. Thank you very much.
Boom.
You didn't lose power, did you? You're still in the same place, right?
Uptown. We didn't. But my my kids were with me. Some friends from downtown came and stayed with me and stuff.
Oh, you let people.
Jay. What was Jay about to say?
I just answered he's talking to me.
Jimmy's
obviously,
questions.
He's talking. Yeah, no, I was.
Yeah.
Nothing. What I usually say.
Did you lose power?
No.
In the Pacific Palisades.
No. We actually gained power. Everything got brighter. Big surge. A big white person surge. A big, if you get on a sitcom, buy a house here surge. And then your show gets canceled and your house goes into fucking syndication. And you're like, oh my God, the mortgage never stops.
Yeah, what
it's
happened?
Like MASH. All right.
This other storm coming up now. I had to tie in an extension cord to my generator. And wired into my panel for heat. It's been like 40 degrees and shit. So, you know, and I was taking the advice of people on Twitter.
Jesus.
So just unscrew the front of your electrical panel, right? Look for the breaker for the furnace. Unscrew it. Tie it together with a piece of an extension cord, the black wire in there. Take the white one, put it on with the rest of the white ones, and then keep blacks and whites separate on the... Because even not with electricity, it's very dangerous to combine the black and the white. Yeah. You get fire. Mm. And then just plug it into the generator, and there
and
you
worked,
go.
Huh?
And the furnace turned on. I'm like, hey, nice! But it looks like it's going to just catch on fire any minute.
It's jerry-rigged?
It doesn't look
good. You jerry-rigged it?
It's not to code at all.
No, not to jerry-rigged code. But you got to turn the mains off, too, because you could
jerry-rigged
backfeed into the line and electrocute a guy that's working on the fucking wires down the line.
That's the price he pays.
Which, after 8 or 9 days without power, I really don't give a shit about the LIPA guy getting zapped by my generator.
He went to ICDC college. That's what you get.
ICDC, which one of
those internet colleges.
Oh, okay.
Regional, I suppose.
Yeah, it probably is.
At this point.
It's like an apex tech here.
Everything you're explaining is like you live in a wagon train. Everybody circle around. We're going to make coffee.
It's fucking crazy.
No, I'm literally completely surprised that you, of all people.
I know.
How did you not knuckle down and see this coming? You seem like the guy that would have...
Well, I have a generator, but it's, you know...
He knuckled down. He just didn't think it was going to be 9 days.
Yes.
And with the looting and stuff, I make sure I'm constantly armed around my house.
Is there looting in your neighborhood?
Not a single peep of looting in my neighborhood.
And maybe it's the fact that you run around your house like Mickey Rourke and Barfly. It's kind of hard to fucking get together and hook that generator up when you're fucking face down on the linoleum at fucking 3 p.m.
Because all the times they've come to put it in and you're like... Go away! Go away!
Who the fuck is that? You're fucking naked
Mr.
with a
Coon,
gun.
We have this. We had an appointment. Go away!
Go away! Not now! Shh!
It's
has
okay,
there
honey.
Been any looting in this storm?
Some
would say.
Coney Island.
What about last night on the internet? I'm reading that there was Black Panthers in Philadelphia and the National Guard
one
was
one guy.
It was one guy.
It was one Black Panther guy, and for some reason he was also...
Why would that intimidate anybody? That would make me laugh.
He was a Democratic observer. So he was actually supposed to be there as an observer and a Black Panther just standing there. It supposedly intimidates people for some reason, but it was an all-Black neighborhood, all-Black school where this polling was being done.
And they had
so he wasn't really intimidated.
Obama mural over one of, at one of the polling places.
In the school,
people,
yeah.
People lost
yeah.
their shit.
Yeah, they
some
covered
guy
it
came up,
the paper.
Up to me while I was when I was voting. I was in a long line, and this guy comes up to me. I did this joke on the SNL monologue about the old lady in the airport, and I say that she was probably a refugee at some point.
And I paint this picture of like
my husband died.
On a muddy, she's on a muddy road, and she's got some kid with a big Jewy hat next to her.
Right? That surprised me when you said that.
They actually said to me, somebody said to me, standards complain, but you know it's life. Do what you want. Yeah. So I did it.
Fantastic.
And then anyway, so some guy comes up to me in line while I'm voting with. I'm with my daughter, and this guy comes up. A big kind of heavy guy, and he's got a lisp, and he's just sort of weird, and he's just kind of aggressive, and he goes, hey, you're that comedian, aren't you? And I go, yeah. And he goes, oh, sure, you're funny, but what's a Jewy hat?
Ugh.
And everybody turns and looks at me.
Holy shit.
And I don't. I just look at him, and he goes, I'm a Jew. Do I have to wear a Jewy hat?
Oh, God, no, this did not happen.
It did happen.
Holy shit.
And I just looked at him with no expression, and then he got nervous. I think he was hoping that I would go, hey, I have the right. And he just,
yeah.
And then it was really awkward.
Oh,
you should have said it's a baseball cap away. With a K on the front. Or a J.
It's a hood.
Or an H.
Do I have to wear one?
Yeah, Jewy hat.
Well, you do.
Oh, God.
You're very Jewy. No, I don't know. I didn't say anything. What are you going to say?
That's
you
kind of weird.
You diffused things well. I thought I would have been self-righteous but that's Louis.
It
would have
been a First Amendment fucking speech right there.
Well, you don't it's like I always, you know, you don't have to say anything yet. Just figure, just look at him and see what happens. What's he going to do now? Yeah.
Now, your move still.
Yeah, exactly.
Move. He didn't have a follow-up.
He thinks that, okay, now you talk.
Move. Yeah,
no,
yeah.
I'm like, still no, I don't have to. Say something else.
It's like passing your turn in Scrabble.
Bye.
Yeah.
And then he went outside and that was the end of it.
And then he went on with his life. Told eight people how shit I said that I didn't say, probably.
Oh, I'm sure it was, you know.
And then he said, how dare you? And I said, here's how I dare.
He said I had horns.
He'll think twice before he makes another Jewy joke.
I think I set him straight.
Yes.
Lisp was bad, huh?
Yeah. He probably, I don't want to say it on the air, but he was probably probably
homosexual. A pitcher.
I'm doing the limp wrist.
Homosexual.
We got an observation from a guy in Tampa.
Oh, good.
This is going to be pretty good for Louis C.K. It's Jay in Tampa. Jay.
Hey, yo, I go back to BAB with you, man. Long time.
Long fucking time. Nice. Jesus.
Louis, love you. I just got a question for you. How is it Shelly can land a DC 10 and float it down the Hudson and you get fucking stuck?
How does it, Joey land?
Oh, Sully to the plane.
Sully can land a plane in the Hudson.
He got stuck in the mud.
2 hours
in. That's an excellent observation.
Yeah.
I don't think you appreciate the complexities of navigating a 34-foot meridian. It's very complicated.
Sully landed in the Hudson River. No one died.
That is a great point. He did a better job with a 737 on the water than he did with a brand new boat. Two cheese sandwiches.
Why are we happy that his boat's all fucked
because
up?
Because
it's hilarious when
there's
a
nothing
fucking
funnier.
Yacht gets wrecked.
Yeah.
It's really great. Well, I don't know why.
What's better than your shitty friend gets a boat and then fucking winds up in the paper because it's in the mud?
Your shitty friend.
The only thing that made me anxious about it being in the paper was that I don't want people knowing that I have a fucking boat.
That's true.
But
instead of
Louis C.K.
It's on Bloomfield Avenue in Clifton.
And all these people online commented and said, that's not a yacht.
Not a yacht.
And I was like, oh, perfect.
A pleasure craft, perhaps.
Yeah.
Yes, there was a disappointment on Louis C.K.'s boat.
Boston Whaler.
Lefty thought that he was going to meet Sam Travicanti, but long way to go for a fucking Donnie Brasco joke. Hey, so what?
I didn't even think you got there yet.
Oh, Jimmy.
Dude, I got my yacht. You blow it up. You put the wooden seat on. You go fishing.
Did you take Bob Kelly in the boat?
Boom. I took Bob Kelly.
Bob talked about it. You know what, dude? Just me and Louis on a boat, dude. Looking at this. What do you think? Just two professionals talking it over. Shithead, you were probably the only one available.
Did you bottom out that time, too, at 1,000 feet? Of water.
Yeah, you were the fucking 18th person he called.
Bobby, these for you.
How was the trip with Bob Kelly?
I went to the Comedy Cellar and he was there, and I said, "Let's go
in a boat."
Nice.
Oh, we were hoping that you weren't on your boat, and all of a sudden you ran over him, and the propeller hit his back, and he popped up.
Manatee.
Yeah.
Manatee.
He's a manatee.
He's got the swirly fucking scar on his back.
Yeah. Hey, dude, it's me. Kind eyes.
I went out on it one night. I took Chris Rock and my manager out on it one night. Chris didn't want to go, and he came anyway. And we went out to the Statue of Liberty. And there was this thing floating in the water. Chris saw it. He said, what is that? And it was this big thing, and it was dark. It was night. It was like 1 a.m. It looked like a raft from a ship, you know, like a big round raft. That's what it looked like to me.
Yeah.
And I yelled over, hey, is anyone in that boat? And it didn't have any lights or anything. And then we noticed that it was coming towards us, like kind of with some speed. And Chris goes, get the fuck away from that thing. Like, it was creepy.
What was
it? So I backed away from it, and I put a light on it, and it was like, it looked like a giant manhole cover sticking out of the river. This was the weirdest night of fucking ever. And it's right by the
nautical mystery.
Yeah, right by the Statue of Liberty. It's like, I don't know, 20 feet across, and it's moving. It's propelling through water.
Are you sure it was moving or didn't just look like
it was leaving a wake?
Wow.
What the fuck?
So,
submarine.
I call up
if the river.
Channel 16. I go, is anyone monitoring this channel? There's something. Because the Staten Island Ferry was very close to there, and I thought it could easily sink any ferry. I would have sunk if I had hit it.
Yeah.
Really? Had you backed away from it by the time you called in?
Yeah. And so I called in, and then this woman came on. This is a New York Harbor Coast Guard. Call, give me your home number. I mean, your phone number if you have a phone. So I give him my number, and this guy calls, and he says, what are you seeing? And I describe it, and he goes, describe it as well as you can. And my manager, I said, what does that look like? He goes, I'm really sorry, but it looks like a submarine. It looks like the top of like the hatch of a submarine. So I go, I don't want to cause a problem, but it looks like the hatch of a submarine. And it's headed towards Lower Manhattan. Like, that's what I'm seeing, and I'm sure it's not that. But my main concern is it's not lit, and it could cream anything that hits. It's going down. And the guy goes, all right, well, I'll call a boat and send him to you. So he hangs up, and like 20 minutes later, there's nobody there. And I call him back, and we have the light on it, and I have this weird feeling, like, is it going to shoot at us? Like, what is this thing? Like, we were really freaking out.
A torpedo fucking starts coming at you.
Yes. Chris Rock fell asleep. Like, he's just like, you guys are idiots, and he went to sleep.
You're white wearing people life
shit.
Vests?
That's white people shit.
No. You don't wear life vests in your boat?
No, I don't usually. But kids do.
Observe water safety.
What are you, fucking Quint?
Never put on a life jacket again.
Take a bat to the radio.
Submarine in the water. Our submarine.
So anyway, I call back, and they're not sending anybody. And I at one point, I got crazy, and I was like, I said, what do you do if somebody's, you are the Coast Guard, and I am saying to you now, there's a submarine attacking Lower Manhattan. Yeah,
this is
I'm
like Jimmy's,
saying it.
This is like Jimmy's story with the bus, only on the water.
Yes,
when you were called for the stolen bus.
Yeah. Like, why wouldn't if that did happen, someone would see it and call in, and they're like, we're trying to get park police over here. I'm like, send a fucking helicopter.
We know about it, Mr. CK.
How do you know my name?
Right. They knew exactly what this thing was.
Oh, wow.
And he kept asking me to hover. We kept hovering around it and stuff. And then finally this big police boat comes and shines like a massive light on it. And then he hails me on the radio. Hey, Captain, are you the one who... reported this? Yeah. And I go, yeah. And he goes, it's a mooring ball. It's been there since 1965. It's just a fucking... And I go, I'm really sorry. I'm really sorry I wasted your time.
You didn't know? You've never seen a bunch of moorings dancing.
No.
I know. That was delicious. Well, that's all right. You thought it was Sean Connery defecting. How are you supposed to know?
Mooring ball. Oh, big iron fucking floating.
It's on a chain.
Yeah, I guess people tie up to it.
Yeah, and like I'm like, what if you don't see it? And everybody, the guy on the, well, most people navigating those waters know what the fuck they're doing.
Right.
That's why.
It's probably marked on a chart that there's a mooring ball
probably
there.
Is.
When you were off to the side getting away from it, because you initially said it was coming towards you, leaving away.
It looks like it was going towards me because it's on a chain to the bottom.
Yeah.
So when the current takes it, it looks like it's moving. It's not just drifting or bobbing.
I was going to say, it must have like just the river moving, the current.
I have no business being on the water because, because it looks like it's moving in one direction to me because I'm fucking moving. So it's making like a circle. And I keep moving around it, and I'm going, holy shit.
Where the fuck
it's
are
going
we?
Going towards...
Jeez, we're really moving far
there's
away.
There's a giant thing coming out of the water. That's the Statue of Liberty, you idiot.
There's like a floating sea from another planet. That's Manhattan, New York City.
It's Atlantis.
I'm sorry.
I found Atlantis. I said that how I thought Anthony would have said it.
That's fucking funny, man.
I love your boat story.
Oh, they're fucking great. There's wonderful. No one that shouldn't have a boat then fucking Louis more than Louis.
It's fun. It's fun as shit to be on it.
I would you have sunk if you hit that, though? That would have killed
oh,
you.
Oh, yeah. Boat. Yeah. And I would have hit it if I hadn't stopped at the Statue of Liberty to show it off to christen them.
Well, so, why don't they have a light on a mooring ball?
Because like... everybody and that's actually out in the open New York Harbor is I'm the only idiot in
they
the whole
know
New York
it's
I'm
there.
The only asshole. It has some tape on it, some reflective tape. That
yeah.
They said it, you know. But yeah, they don't expect
submarines
some
put reflective.
They
tape
do.
On
they
their
like
hatches.
To be seen. Nice.
I'm sure if you
don't trip when you're
chart.
Coming off stage on the submarine. We'll put some electrical tape down so you can see it when you're coming off on the steps.
Tape down the cable.
I'm sure if you looked at. Like thank where you were and looked at a chart, it would probably be there.
Probably.
Like mooring ball.
It's an old mooring ball.
625.
And if a big tanker wants to sit there, it hitches
yeah,
to the
then
ball.
They just, instead of dropping an anchor.
Is that because it's too, this way it prevents it from going to the shallower water to get close? It can do it in the deep water.
Yeah, it's simpler. Mooring balls are so you don't have to throw an anchor down.
Yeah, that's a pain
you
in the ass.
You just hook up to it and you're,
hang out.
You're there.
How heavy is a fucking mooring ball that it can keep a ship in place? What's it latch into the water with?
But it's yeah, how big was it?
Chains. Big chains.
Well, how big
does
it
float?
A safety pin.
What?
How could it be that heavy and float?
Well, like any, like you know, like a ship, like a aircraft carrier is pretty heavy.
It's a big hollow ball.
It has buoyancy.
Full of air.
Buoyancy.
And at the like, bottom, it's a giant fucking
it's really
anchor
hard to push air down
cement.
to the underwater.
Yeah, that's very hard.
Yeah. Yeah. Air is difficult.
Yeah.
That's a great difficult. Fucking story.
That is fantastic.
Two horrible boat stories.
And you stayed yeah. there. You stayed there.
For like an hour.
To
look at it, man.
To find out what was it for safety purposes for other people, or to find out what it was.
No, I was concerned with about somebody wrecking into it.
Really? Yeah.
I wanted to go. I didn't want to be doing it. I wanted to go home, but
you probably thought it was terrorism.
You're when you do when you the boat shit they give you to read.
Yeah.
It, you know you're responsible for everybody out there.
Ah,
so.
Yeah, yeah. Were you like running through a fantasy in your head of Louis C.K. fucking terrorists thwarted by comic yes. Louis C.K.
You know what's great? All Anthony said was Louis C.K. and we all burst out.
Yeah, we all knew the text. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, he's just daydreaming like, yeah.
Yes, everybody's going to know now them. That I'm really a captain.
Homeland Security. Yes. But instead the headline reads, in quotes, comic arrested for pranking police department. Yeah.
Comic, local. Comic.
Yeah, you thought that there was going to be good, cool. You saw something and you said something. Good job.
That's it. Local comic known for playing grandpa's comedy club in Yonkers.
Comes across a piece of hardware that's been there since the World's Fair.
Yes. Yes, calling the police for being attacked by a giant bowling ball. It's a big circle and it's just hanging out there for 51 years.
That's
fun. Finally, somebody caught it.
God, that's fucking great, man. Well, look at the time.
Yeah, should we fucking
late.
Call it?
I have, shit.
I go to the gym before therapy.
I would love
is
to not
kettlebell day?
To go home.
What are you doing today?
Fire I don't, probably system. Cardio because I have therapy.
What's today?
Wednesday.
Oh, Wednesday. How'd you do neck?
It's fucking arms. upper body
I
today.
I just do
upper
neck.
Upper body.
On Wednesday?
Pull-ups.
On day, Anthony, I gotta do neck only.
When's the kettlebell day?
Sets of one.
Push-ups where you fucking, you go down. There's no cheating on these push-ups. You go down, lift your hands up off the fucking... floor, and then you gotta go again. Hands up off the floor.
What are you talking about?
You can't fucking push
it. Cheating. That is cheating.
No. Sure it is.
Yeah. What are you talking about?
Your chest on the floor.
Your chest is on the floor.
And cheer. Your arms go up, so you can't just do these. You're only moving like 2 inches.
How about you just make sure you're an inch off the floor?
No. How about you fucking?
You engage your core more with what Anthony is saying.
Exactly.
Because your hands are all the way up.
Very difficult.
Gonna have to try.
But
that
I'm just
one.
Doing neck.
Very difficult.
Just neck today, huh, Colin?
Just neck.
Just neck. Sets of one or two. It's a big weight take for me.
Neck.
I did a little too many core arms last night.
That's unbelievable.
Oh, I know.
I spoke at a friend of mine's house. He said, Colin, why don't you come over? I said, it's not that good of a story, you know? What do you want me to do? What am I, some great orator all of a sudden? Like, oh, here comes Colin with a filibuster about his friend's house. Jesus. All right, you got 2 Emmys. I'm doing neck.
It's not even just the voice. It's
totally
it's what's
him.
Being said.
The cadence.
Yes.
The no, everything.
Face.
And the appropriate defeated term.
Jesus. That's fantastic, Jay.
You threw Colin off today when he called in.
Oh, no, yeah. A couple of times during this time, he's done it and I've jerked my head over like this. I swear, I forgot.
My favorite is Eddie Vedder, but...
No better today.
That's all right. You did a lot last time.
We're all very proud of Louis C.K. He's been a friend of ours for a very long time. Louis is one of the greats. A good guy, you know. This is dissident. I like to say nothing before every song, and it really just evaporates the time that you have and you spend. Dick Cheney's the world's biggest asshole. He said that when I saw him.
Really?
And I was like, you didn't play Jeremy yet. You're the world's biggest asshole. What are we, girlfriends now?
Get Jeremy over with, and then you can talk about Dick Cheney.
Fucking, when you do your set, and then when the house lights come on at 11, come back out, we'll have a little pilot talk. Fucking little Eddie, but you jerk.
Eddie, what do you think of the election last night?
I think it was a victory for all Americans, and for the African-American, a Polish-American, American-American. But we don't see color in this band. The only color we see is black. This is black.
That is such a fucking great Eddie Vedder, man.
Fucking love it's really it. Good.
You gotta make sure you vote. If you vote, then you can complain all you want.
Is he pretending to be Scottish or something, that guy?
He's a little bit. And on Twitter last night, people said, do you realize you're doing Johnny Depp?
So now I gotta go watch a whole bunch of fucking Johnny Depp movies and work another impression that no one will laugh at into my act. If I gotta do Harvey Keitel for 8 minutes just to make Joe DeRosa laugh, the audience is staring at me like I'm a jerk. You say the goddamn words! DeRosa's gonna be okay!
But can you imagine Eddie Vedder talking to Jack Nicholson?
Well...
We have a real celebrity in the house. Normally, we don't turn the house lights on, people, because we want you to have your anonymity and be a group part of the group. But, my God, four easy pieces. Jack Nicholson is here tonight joining us.
Hey, Pearl Jam, here's Johnny.
I say we don't know Johnny, but we know Jeremy.
Observation, Louis C.K. is officially a big deal because a guy we rarely see is waiting to say hi to you. Scott Greenstein.
Look at that.
He only comes around for the big guys.
Man, oh, yeah.
He'll give you some kind of line of bullshit. Is he? Oh, he's listening. Fuck you.
I don't care. Spoken like a man who hasn't...
I got a contract. I don't give a
Colin
fuck.
Colin Vedder just crashed in my face.
Really said,
wow. Spoken like a man that has a contract.
Have him come in and say hi.
Spoken like a man.
There's something that you do stuff with your face when you make it. Colin, you get your...
Colin's the same face as... This is the same face as Keitel.
What the fuck was Louis thinking?
Two Emmys.
He didn't take anyone.
And then Colin is just a little more.
Colin's got that.
And Vedder is just drunk on red wine because if it takes all night, well, then that's all right. I enjoy elevator rides with Opie. Make sure you see his YouTube channel.
I have a question about the Emmys.
Oh,
yeah.
Did you win the first one you were nominated for?
I mean, the first one that came up? Yeah, we were the first. I mean, category was like second on the whole night.
Jeez.
And cool. When you lose it, are you thinking like, fuck, or is it like, I already got
one? No, it's like, it should be, like, what I would say, the answer I would say, because I want to sound like I'm a really down-earth dude.
Yeah.
You know, I won that one, then I was like, then I was set for the night. But I'm greedy, like everybody else. So I actually didn't, I wish I had won that one last, because I would have been like, fuck, yes, I got one.
Yeah.
But I won one, and I'm like, all right, okay, but how many more?
I could get more.
Yeah, so I didn't properly enjoy two that I won, because there was still more coming up. Like, okay, how many am I getting? And then when I'm done, when I lost the last one, I was like, all right, well, two is good.
That's two.
No, I'll totally cop to that.
Where are the Emmys right now?
It brought out the worst in me.
Where are
they?
The
whole thing.
Where'd you put them?
I got them on my boat. One on my desk and one on the thing.
Yeah, the boat. You get to tie a rope and throw to food.
Yeah. to the mooring ball.
To the tree somewhere in Jersey.
Get a whole chicken and stick it on one of his wings. Exactly. We're starving over here, you
think? I would have happily done that with the weight of them.
You were nominated for more than anybody else ever, though, right? Seven?
Seven, yeah.
Wow.
That's fucking amazing.
Ever?
Yeah,
that's the most ever.
David Lynch was on my show. He was
fucking
the,
great.
Dude, the David Lynch prior record with Five.
That wow. David Lynch shit was amazing.
I didn't realize it was him
fucking
at first.
Amazing.
Like I'm watching it.
He's like
and
the best actor I ever
amazing.
Had on the show.
He was that fucking. And,
fuck
and
yeah.
it's kind of being involved
so
with some
far,
of those people. Being, yeah.
So,
oh, that was so
right,
fucking
Jay.
Good. Being involved with those people on some level,
yeah.
that was he played the perfect network guy.
No, it was,
no,
it
was unbelievable.
It was perfect.
He didn't want to do it either. It took me like 10. I wrote him
really?
Many emails, and he was writing back, I love the scripts, but you really ought to get somebody
Go.
Else. I'm
wow.
not an actor.
Oh, is he good.
He pulled it off. Gary Marshall
yeah.
was amazing, too.
Gary Marshall.
That,
yeah,
that
yeah.
one monologue he gave was chilling.
Unbelievable. And he's an old he's an old man.
He's been in here.
Yeah, yeah,
and
he's great.
Fucking kicked ass.
Nailed it was it. Chilling. That
did he
monologue.
Do that just as you had written it, or did he improv
exactly.
that at all? From his, oh, okay. So
exactly.
he did as an actor did it.
Yep. He said every word exactly.
I love the Dane episode from way back.
Yeah, that was good. Dane did great.
When you,
Dane
yeah,
did
he
a
did.
Really good
and
job.
And you, I've been defending Dane forever, so I was happy to just, you had him on.
Dane's a good guy.
He's a very
oh,
nice guy.
A black yeah. wife. Yeah, we what? Haven't talked to you about this season.
Yeah, yeah.
Also, you just throw a black wife in
yeah.
there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
With white kids.
She's a good actress.
That's all you need.
She, you know what? The one scene in the Late Show 3-part run,
right.
there's a scene where she says, you have to get this job.
Yeah.
She did that better than anybody. That's really what got her to the job.
Wow. And you didn't feel like you had to explain
it. I didn't know
anything.
Because if I had known how good she was going to be, I might have started with black kids. But I didn't happen in the order it happened.
Right.
I'd already picked the kids. And she was just the best one, so I decided, some people will go, what is that? But I don't care if they say
I
that.
I love that you didn't explain it.
Who cares? Man?
Yeah,
there would have
Why
been
explain
to
it?
Try
Fuck
to explain it, because
no,
there was no
just
explanation.
Let it, be.
It just is
one.
What it
Fuck
is.
It. And the other thing was the motorcycle.
Yeah.
Did you ride motorcycles before that episode?
Yeah, I used to ride
bit.
One regularly.
Yeah.
And back in the day, I know you had one.
Yeah, I had one.
And used to ride on your walls in your apartment.
That's right.
And
yeah,
you know,
no, Jay and I were, we did the, we were like in village clubs together for a long
oh,
time.
Oh, really?
Back in the day, yeah.
And then Louis shot past me on a rocket ship.
Well, you shot past first.
I was hot shit for a while.
You shot past first.
Yeah.
Yeah, Jay showed
and
up.
And I gave an ex-wife every penny I ever
this
earned.
This fucking
oh.
skinny kid
and I'm
from,
a fucking ham and egger.
This kid from New Jersey shows up, a skinny kid, and he just gets every fucking possible gig. And actually, I learned a lesson from Jay's coming up, because I remember thinking, I mean, I had been doing it for a while, and he shot right past me, and he was younger than me. He hadn't been doing it as long. But I thought, he's not taking my gigs. He's getting his, and I was happy for him. He was the first person that like he's the guy on which I processed that idea.
Yeah,
that it's got nothing to do with me. That's his success. Mm. And also, Jay had so many fucking tools. He's got this rubber voice, and he had this a funny arrogance. Like he was a cocky kid, and it
yeah.
was funny.
Yeah.
I'm
it was
happy
funny
to hear you guys discussing this too, as opposed to me in the mirror every morning, who I just repeat, slow and steady wins the race.
That funny arrogance I've learned in subsequent podcasts bred a lot of hate.
That's okay, man.
It is now.
You leave a trail of a bunch. Yeah, it is now, and that's all it has to be.
I
mean,
I think when you identify that it's not really a proper way to behave to strangers, like,
right.
look at these fucking assholes sitting at a table, and it's like, we don't really know who you are, and now we just think you're a dick.
Oh, shit.
Because you're used to hanging out with, like, you know, Jimmy and Louie and Patrice at the Cellar.
Just your
and
friends,
then,
yeah.
Then you go someplace else to L.A. with fucking L.A. comics, you're like, look at these fucking assholes.
John,
hey,
also, when
you
doing,
assholes?
Like,
it doesn't work out the same way, huh?
When you did the acting like Jerry Maguire, everybody respected that. That was a fucking trademark
huge.
Role.
Huge.
It was great.
I wish I did it now.
It's a great part.
It'd be a way bigger deal because everybody would know who I was.
Oh, shit.
That's the guy that is Eddie Vedder got that job?
This is awkward, Jerry. You should say something.
It's real.
Great line.
You want it smaller. You want it smaller. I get it. Crowded race.
What?
I try to do. I can only do Tom Cruise's laugh smile. So I was pointing at Louis as Tom Cruise. I get it. Crowded restaurant.
That's really good.
So there's no scene. You unctuous. You wanted smaller. I still don't know all those words. My wife goes, how come you remember everything you've ever... I go, because everything I've ever done only lasted a year. If anything was ever successful, it would be a fucking blur. Saturday Night Live, 2 years. Gary I'm Married, 2 years. Jeff Foxworthy Show, 5 episodes. Like everything I've ever done, or a movie's like 3 weeks.
Action.
Action, 8 episodes.
Yeah.
So it's not like, you know, if Gary Unmarried went like 5 years, it's like, oh, just garbage in, garbage out. I don't know what the fuck I said. Like, she was on three shows that went 5 years each time.
Jesus.
Of course you don't remember anything. Like, Louis doesn't know dialogue from season one, do you?
For, of what? My show?
We're out of time. Listen. All
right. All right, we should wrap up. Jay Moore can be at Governor's.
Sorry.
Friday, Saturday, Sunday, right? Out there on Long Island?
Yeah, if there's no power, come on out to Governor's and we'll keep you warm with laughter.
Jesus. Lou, you promoting anything? What do you got, buddy?
Well, I'm going to do that. I think the Saturday before Thanksgiving, I'll be at... the Staten Island thing.
Good.
And so it'll be on my website. Okay. And it will be a place on the website to give money to people in Staten Island.
Ooh.
That's pretty fucking nice.
I think what we're going to do is have the tickets be like $90 and then you're getting a ticket and then you're buying one for somebody there. So we'll raise money and people get to see the show whose houses are
maybe it's underwater. What about the people that just were not affected on Staten Island at all? How are you gonna?
We have a way to tell them to go fuck themselves. We'll see.
And Jimmy,
I will be in Buffalo New Year's Eve, December 28th through the 31st. I'm at the Helium Comedy Club in Buffalo, and this Thursday through Saturday, November 15th through 17th, at the Addison Improv.
Good club.
It's great. Addison
Improv. I love Dallas.
That's a great club.
I love that room, and I'm gonna love Buffalo.
Yes.
New Year's Eve.
Kenny's fired up about it.
Is he? You think?
Why did I fucking... Oh. Why?
What do you mean, why? For money.
For doubloons.
But I know why. I mean, I understand.
Meet Buffalo.
Tell me why. No, but I mean, the weather is going to be hot.
Tell me why, Jake. Why? Why are we going to come all the way to Cleveland for you to get beat by a fucking hooligan? Why?
You want to go in and fight him?
Yeah. It's going to be cold.
Let's get out of here.
What?
Yeah.
What?
All right.
You got a big shot that wants Jake to say hi to you, though.
Great. Louis. Thanks so much.
Do I have to do that?
Oh, man.
It's you just can do nonsense. Whatever you like.
Make believe you don't speak English.
Go uptown.
Listen, make believe you don't speak English.
He's going
to.
This
might be hard to convince him.
Yeah, it's just nonsense.
He doesn't. He's a radio guy.
Well, that's true.
Oh, yeah. He doesn't know what he looks like.
This is Bugs.
Bugs. All right, Jay Moores.
Later.
CK, great seeing you, and we'll see you guys tomorrow.
The Opie and Anthony Show is available later today with SiriusXM On Demand. You've heard about it. You've waited 4 long hours for it. Finally, the moment is at hand. After Opie and Anthony Live is coming up next! Yeah!